41 days now until the incredibly historic, epic election. I'm your host, Alex Jones. We're live on this Tuesday, the 27th day of September 2016. Paul Watson hosts the fourth hour today. We don't have any guest. I might have one or two pop in, but no guests right now because I want to get to a lot of the clips. Obviously, from the debate last night, I want to take your phone calls. I normally don't have any problem telling people what I think about something, but what happened last night was such a bizarre train wreck on so many levels that I really had to cogitate on the subject deeply. Overall, Trump won the debate just by sheer moral weight, gravitational weight. The whole thing obviously was rigged. You have Holt, who I thought would be a lot fairer. I mean, I was wrong saying I think he'll be more fair than what we saw in earlier debates between the Republicans and the Democrat candidates. And boy, was I wrong. He ran off at the end like he was totally embarrassed. He didn't look like he enjoyed attacking Trump like some of the Fox News people have done during the Republican debates. Of course, Megyn Kelly, who just looks like she wants to kill him or something. I mean, she just looks like she scorned or something, like she's in love with him but hates him at the same time. You know, there's just such energy and venom and poison. I didn't see that from Holt, and I don't normally see that when he reports. That's why he doesn't really come off as super arrogant and hateful, just confident, and that made it even worse. I can't stand him now. It was horrible. It was so rigged, but in their attempt to rig everything, that's what blew up in their face and why every poll out there, I mean, we've got like 10 of them here, scientific polls, you name it, on Democratic Party platforms, you name it, liberal platforms, like Time Magazine, MSNBC, you name it, saying Donald Trump won massively. Michael Moore says he won massively, except CNN. They have her winning by 60%+, when in every other poll, he was winning by 10 to 15 points. And we're talking about polls with samples of over a million voters on Time Magazine, 1.6 million. Drudge, massive numbers. I'll dig them out here in a moment. 80-something% for Trump. Hillary, if you remember in Democrat debates, was way behind Sanders, but it didn't matter because she just stole the election. So we got CNBC has her at 33%, Trump at 67% with 994,000 votes. Boy, we should have put out a poll last night. We were just so busy we didn't think of it. We should put a poll up ourselves. What do you think? Who do you think won the debate? And then have another poll asking, was it a fair debate? Was it tipped towards Trump or was it tipped towards Hillary? And of course, we'll see what the listeners and folks have to say about that. But I would imagine if you polled Democrats, they would have to admit, in fact, I see a lot of them in the press going, yeah, it kind of was stacked against Trump. I mean, there's got to be some level of basic fairness in people. When you're watching everything rigged against Trump, everything rigged against populism, everything always stacked against us, and we continue to win. And I think that this is really blown up in their face. I mean, I really, really have been thinking about it hard. Last night, I kind of felt like he didn't come out hard enough and was a little bit disappointed. But I got to tell you, I slept on it, and I really thought about it. I think this was a big victory because it was so staged against him. Wow. What a debate last night. What a staged event. I am rarely wrong, but I thought that Lester Holt would be more fair. It was one of the most unfair debates I've ever seen, where he became the third debater. It was 2-1 last night. I'm really ashamed of Lester Holt. I'm really ashamed of NBC. But that's why the establishment is in so much trouble right now. They're in all this trouble because they're rigging the system in front of everyone, and the general public is not in the dark like they were decades ago. They're aware of the rigging, and they're getting more informed about the rigging every single day. But it's so transparent. We're going to walk through in this hour the poll numbers. Across the spectrum, Trump won by 10 to 15 points. In scientific polls, in mass polls, you name it, every different type of poll, unscientific, scientific, internet, crowdsourced, you name it. When you had big samples of hundreds of thousands or millions of people, and depending on the poll we're going to go over, he was 10 to 15 to 20 in some cases, 20 points ahead. Except for one poll, CNN took phone calls, 500 and something of them, and then out of that sample, it's very easy to rig a small sample, why Hillary won by a huge margin. So the rigging of the Clinton News Network just continues, and there's an article that's up on Infowars.com that is extremely important that gets into the fact that that was a rigged debate. Rigged. CNN poll claiming Hillary won the debate sampled 41% Democrats compared to 26% Republicans. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the insanity of how dumb they think you are. Reuters does this where they, again, sample 15%, 10%, depending on the poll, more Democrats, to then give her a 10, 15% lead. It's just clear, cut and dry fraud, but they put it three or four or five pages down, depending on the methodology, at the bottom. They tell you, oh, well, this person won the race, you know, across the English Channel swimming, but this person wasn't wearing lead weights around their ankles like the person they beat. But it says at the bottom, the person they beat, who normally would beat this other individual, was wearing 50 pounds of lead weights. Or it's like saying, this horse won the Kentucky Derby, but we gave it a head start of 500 yards. But they tell you in fine print that they gave the horse a head start. Now, no one would put up with that because you're at the Kentucky Derby. Everybody's wearing their silly hats. You know, the Queen of England's there. It's all this big to-do, and the gates open and outrun the horses. But imagine if they let a horse get, you know, let's say a quarter way around the track, running before the other horses were allowed out. Well, you know, if that horse is even half decent, it's going to win. This is the naked, brazen, high noon fraud. And I've got stacks of it. I mean, we've got Holt going after Trump 41 times, interrupting him, and only doing it 7 times with Hillary. And then his, quote, fact-checking of her wasn't fact-checking. It was basically supporting her. He asked her one tough question. Trump, 41 times. So I thought that they'd be smart and try to at least look fair, but they are so arrogant that they obviously told Holt, go after him with both barrels. And Holt then, Lester Holt, discredited, disgraced Holt, ran off like a rat out of an aqueduct. He, you know, like a wet rat, he just shot out of there, running off after he'd engaged in his Judas errand. Wow. I was talking to one of our producers, Zach, in there this morning. He really just in like 2 minutes was showing me all these articles. And I was already aware of most of it, but it was the way he laid it out, just shaking his head and then going over the methodology. Where it isn't enough that they have all their little sweetheart, you know, Democrats that they call for this poll. They then admit they sampled almost double. I mean, you think Reuters is bad adding 15% more Democrats in their polls. When they got caught doing that, they went, oh, we'll just do 10% or 5% or, oh. But then, oh, then they got caught, like Bloomberg, with the, quote, independents. 20% of our poll are independents. It turns out they're not independents. They're almost all Democrats or Green Party people that go, oh, well, actually, I don't like Donald Trump. It's shameful. And now there's articles out where hundreds to one, big money is giving money to Hillary. Now, we already know that, but just let that sink in. And I say this to Bernie supporters, and they almost all go, I don't care. I still can't vote for Trump, but I don't like Hillary. I don't know what to do. And I go, do you understand you say you're against big money? And big money worldwide is illegally coming in against Trump, and they're just letting them do it at the Justice Department that is so incredibly criminal. And they're running around when Trump talks about, hey, if Hillary doesn't want you to have bodyguards, then how about she doesn't have bodyguards? Like, hey, Hollywood folks have bodyguards, but they don't want you to have bodyguards, your own bodyguard. And then they call that a threat by Trump. And there's articles all the time, you know, that Alex Jones wants violence against Hillary. I was talking to one of our Pentagon friends today, and he was saying that there was a Justice Department investigation of yours truly going on. Because I had a security analyst here just doing some security stuff on the building, and we got into my gun safe, just looked at some of them, had some fun, talked about going out shooting, didn't have time. And one of the folks in here, about a third of the tweets are mine, the rest of the crew sending out news alerts and things. I said, yeah, you know, show us, you know, getting these rifles out, quote, for our security. And Hillary come out and called me dark heart and all this. So I don't think Hillary would actually come after me, but her minions could. Some crazy person, one of her followers. So we made the joke, yeah, after Hillary, you know, basically put out this threat, we've had to up our security. A whole investigation, I'm very honored, about what we're doing over here and are we setting up a paramilitary base. And I'd already heard this months ago before I put that tweet out, or before the crew did. This is the woman that invades Libya. She came, she saw, he died. They've killed hundreds of thousands of Christians in Syria. They're involved in all these crimes, and then they want to project that Donald Trump wants violence or that Rush Limbaugh was behind the Oklahoma City bombing. Remember that within 25 minutes of it happening? Talk radio was to blame. The alt-right, we're violent, we want violence. That's what Paul Watson keeps predicting, and he's so smart. He believes they're going to stage a false flag against Hillary or her supporters or a mass killing that is then blamed on the Liberty Movement. And I think clearly they could even try to set us up. I think they're looking at who they want to set up. They're looking at who they want to connect it to. And we're way out ahead of that. And so let me explain what our weapons are. Our weapons are cameras and keyboards and search engines and research and our guests and our listeners and our will to be free Americans and to try to restore this republic and make it great again. We're the ones trying to stop George Soros starting a civil war. We're the ones trying to stop foreign funding and Ford Foundation funding and the hundreds of millions every few months, this is mainstream news, to foment race war and to start a civil war against local governments meant to wipe out the police, basically. That's who runs the Justice Department. The ideological godmother of Black Lives Matter is in Cuba for killing a police officer. This is what Loretta Lynch, these people are all into. They're a bunch of paranoid, crazy leftists that probably actually think we're here building an army. When they're the ones building the armies and have people out saying, kill cops, and then the cops are getting killed, and then the cops are scared to go into the neighborhoods, so the crime rate's basically doubled in many black cities in just 2 years. Chicago's more than doubled the violent crime. I mean, it's hell on earth. You people are killing yourselves. The globalists are killing their own Democrat cities. It's so sad. And then they want to project that we're here, a major media operation with all of Hillary's crazy followers and the Mexican mafia threatening Trump and threatening everybody else for that matter. And we say, oh yeah, we're up on our security. And then they turn that into an entire spin machine. That's just what I'm getting at here is they sit there with a straight face. We played this last week and asked the vice presidential candidate, the Republicans, the nominee, Mr. Pence, Governor Pence, is Donald Trump calling for violence or are you planning violence? He's like, what? We're obviously saying she has taxpayer paid for bodyguards. She shouldn't take the American people's guns. And she said last night that she wants extrajudicial, no due process, put you on a no-gun buy list, just put you on it whenever they feel like it, outside of law. And you better believe they'd love to put me on that list and say I can't protect myself from the armies of criminals that support the Democratic Party. The Chinese communists, the Saudi Arabians. There's articles about the big Mexican drug cartels are flooding money into Hillary's campaign through big banks. Because these criminal operations know Donald Trump means business, folks. We're going to skip this network break. But if they're going to steal the nomination from Bernie Sanders, and they're going to stage polls, and they're going to have Holt interrupt Trump 40-plus times and Hillary 7, don't you know they're going to go for broke? There was the miracle, as Drudge calls it last night, medical miracle. She stands for 90 minutes. She looked sick. She looked haggard. She looked wounded. I almost felt sorry for her, but she's such a vampire. But she looked better than she did a few weeks ago. Whenever Trump calls her Secretary of State, tries to be nice to her, he says, is that okay? And then she sexy smiles at him like, oh, you're my friend. Oh, thank you. And it was the first time I've seen Hillary Clinton ever look genuine. We're going to find that clip. It's early in the debate. We're going to play that a little bit later. Oh, you already have it? Okay, we'll play it in a moment. I'm going to get back into the rigging and actually go over the numbers. And it was the first time I've seen Hillary look genuine. And it actually hurt me for a minute because I don't like hating people. I don't like going after people. I don't like going after dangerous kingpins like her. But I have to, and I know she's got a horrible history. But I innately, as a man, don't like to be mean to women. And they play on that. They played on that with Trump. And so I almost started having guilt saying all these bad things about her when she acted human for just one moment. And boy, Trump, by the end, goes, you suckered me in. I came in here and I really hit above the belt, and you didn't. And then she had these little evil looks in her eyes like, absolutely, I fooled you. I betrayed you. That's what they're all about, people. That's their spirit. Why would Madeleine Albright, saved by the Serbs in World War II when she was a teenager, go out of her way repeatedly to bomb Belgrade and attack the Serbs and bring Muslims in and frame them and set them up and have the media demonize them when the Serbs, folks, were clearly the good guys overall. They didn't start the wars. It was their area historically. They did some atrocities, but the UN admitted double the atrocities by the Muslims. And her father was a rich Jew that swindled Jews and stole Jews' goods, claiming he'd get them out of the country, basically a George Soros. This is on record. There have been 60 Minute shows about this, where they have, like, you know, multi-million dollar stolen art in her house in Georgetown. And the Serbs were on TV saying, why? You lived here for years during World War II. We saved you. The Germans invaded Serbia. We hid you. Why are you doing? Why do you go out of your way to do this to us? Because she's a demon, people. And that's what they're all about, is betrayal. You have to understand them. Betrayal is the name of their game. They want to serve evil. They're evil. I don't say that to demonize them. It's true. They're all about sucking us in. They're all about conning us. And everybody knows in the establishment, Trump's for real, folks. He's not perfect, but he's for real. He wants prosperity, and the system can't stand it. So we do have that clip of Hillary. I mean, I couldn't believe it. She turned it on. And I remember thinking for a minute, you know, she's called Trump her husband repeatedly, and I know that she likes powerful men and controlling them, and so obviously he's very attractive to her. You know, she's reportedly bisexual, and so I think maybe it was genuine in that her femininity allowed her to have some shred of human connection that wasn't an evil robot, because the woman is a robot. Even the Democrats can't stand her and are in panic mode. I mean, the woman is becoming more robotic by the day, more reptilian, and I don't mean literally reptilian. So let's go ahead and play that clip.
Secretary Clinton? Yes. Is that okay? Good. I want you to be very happy. It's very important to me.
Now, that clip is from a different mainstream news feed. The one I saw was from the feed we had, and it was straight onto her face, and it was even more genuine. I actually had like a... that feeling when you drive over a hill and you know, your stomach drops, kind of like a... is that a good feeling or a bad feeling? Well, I just saw humanity out of Hillary Clinton. Wow, that was amazing. Now, that said, I want to get back into fraud. If you just tuned in, the unprecedented rigging. CNN putting out a fake poll, admittedly. We're going to show you the methodology from their own website in a moment. All the other polls saying the opposite. Lester Holt hitting him 40-plus times with interruptions and attacking him and misrepresenting and then just saying Trump was wrong and that Trump wasn't telling the truth on a whole bunch of subjects that Trump was absolutely right on. I mean, my head was spinning. And when I say spinning, I mean last night, everything coming out of her mouth was a lie. And the TPP, she says she's not for the TPP. She was the main, we've played the clips. We ought to find those today. We've got a TPP report on her where Hillary gets up and says, I've been negotiating for years on this and I've been spearheading, getting it done. It's the most important thing ever. And I'm the most proud of this in my government service. I mean, she's one of the main lawyers and as Secretary of State, one of the main people negotiating that and was who Obama would send to negotiate it. I mean, she is one of the main authors. Remember, she called it the gold standard and called it her work. Now, that's from the LA Times. We can play the clips, but that's what I mean. It was otherworldly. The only time she told the truth was the fact that she wants to take your guns with no due process, which is just the end of the Fourth Amendment, the Fifth Amendment, the end of right to juries, right to habeas corpus. I mean, it's head spinning. But first, let's get into the polls. Rigged. CNN poll claiming Hillary won the debate sampled 41% Democrats compared to 26% Republicans. This is Paul Joseph Watson. We need to get this article out everywhere, folks. This is so important. But then it gets worse. Let's walk through all of this. Zach, one of the producers. Zach, break it down.
All right, Alex. So I was on Drudge this morning. I'm printing out my articles as always. And there was two polls on there from Time Magazine and CNBC showing a clear lead in Trump polling that he won the debate. So then I wanted to see both sides of the equation. I just went on CNN, and of course you see the post debate poll saying that Hillary Clinton was the winner. So I was interested in how they gathered the information on the debate polling. So I scroll down, and if you go all the way to the bottom of this article, you find out that there was a phone poll that they had pre-screened callers, called 521 people, asked them if they wanted to be a part of the poll debate, the debate polling, sorry, after the fact. So they called them after the debate was done and asked them a handful of questions. And of course, Paul has already unveiled that 41% of those people were Democrats. And in comparison to all the other polls that I've found, it is a huge difference in numbers. Now, if you jump to CNBC, you'll see that it's a completely different story.
We're going to get to that in a moment, but let's be clear here. They did 41% self-identified Democrats. Mm-hmm. Then they called them back. Okay, so they call under the debate. They call them back to hand-rig this thing with their little Democrat interns, and they're literally running the show, CNN getting their daily talking points from Hillary. That's come out in the emails. 41% were Democrats, 26% Republicans. That is almost double more Democrats than it is Republicans. That is sensationally naked. That is in your face. Now let's look at the other polls that didn't have 500, but that had over a million. Let's go to those.
Okay. So first we have the CNBC. If you see here, you scroll down a little bit, you see it's a 33% in favor of Hillary, and it's 325,000 votes. And then you see Donald Trump is pushing 67, it's 669,000 votes.
And remember, News, Republicans are statistically supposedly older, less tech savvy, but the more tech savvy you are now, and big countries that and companies that aggregate numbers are freaking out, Google and others are saying no, and so is Facebook. That's why they're putting everything behind Hillary right now. They know she's really way behind.
And another thing that I wanted to point out, too, I read a Wired article a long time ago about they were a small-time company that's doing analytics called Civis, and they did a poll on just phone calls in general, and they said that in the fractions of people are responding to these phone polls, which is why it's even more unbelievable to me to see CNN pushing this as this is the narrative.
They absolutely handpick it. They absolutely already have these vetted pools they go to. Let's show some of the other polls that you mentioned then. Let's. You were getting to another one.
Yes, Fox News. They don't show their numbers, but they show the 50% lead, of course, to favor Trump as well. If you scroll down, you see you could vote. It's 50% Donald Trump, 34%
for Hillary. And it's the same thing when you go to basically every other major polling area.
And Time Magazine, once again, was another one.
That's 1.69 million voting, and we'll show those numbers. He, again, has a huge lead there. Let's scroll down to that and show the TV viewers. 55% Donald Trump, 45% Hillary. So all the big polls show the same thing, which is why you know it's accurate, but not CNN because they're living in la-la land. Thank you, Zach. We'll be back with more. All right. I want to get to some of the debate clips themselves here in a moment. I also want to open the phones up. See, you can call in with your take on this. And I want to be specific. If you disagree with me about the debate, you will go to the head of the line. That's a rule I have that if you disagree, I will do my best to get to you first. Now, I kind of have an old rule that if somebody's calling from really far away in the world, I'll try to go to that caller even ahead of somebody that disagrees. But I'd like to really hear from Bernie Sanders supporters that have been calling in. One of them called in yesterday. She was a nice lady, and she said, well, you know, we were Bernie Sanders supporters, but we can't support Trump or Hillary. We're really concerned. And I was like, lady, all the big money is against Trump, all the big globalists. Do you understand that? And she just didn't even listen to me. And everybody I talked to that says that they basically try to talk to these Sanders supporters, they get the same brick wall where you're talking common sense to them, but they just can't hear it because they're stuck on Donald Trump's a racist and I can't vote for a racist because their whole identity is about they're good and they're not racist. That's their possession, is being obsessed with race, which is the essence of being a racist. What's taught in this culture is the opposite of what Martin Luther King said. And a lot of right-wingers didn't like Martin Luther King, so I get criticism. That guy was a communist and all this other stuff. Yeah, he did speak at events that were communist-affiliated. He was also a registered Republican. I mean, give me a break. It's like saying I've been on Russian TV, I work for the Russians. But then you've got the left now that's totally abandoned Martin Luther King, which Martin Luther King, I've read his writings, I've watched his speeches, not just the I Have a Dream stuff. He was a really focused, well-spoken, common sense, smart person that was promoting unity, which is the opposite of what the Democratic Party promotes. And she basically said in one of her clips we've got that everyone is implicitly racist. And I've got to say that a whole new generation of people were not being brought up like that. But that's all been hijacked now by the multicultural Marxist, and they are using race to control people just like the KKK did in the South, and it is shameful. I mean, I am really ashamed of Democrats and how far they've sunk. I've been a big critic of Republicans. Everybody knows that. This is a repudiation of the Republican establishment. They're freaking out. The foreign banks are freaking out. The big Democrat machine is freaking out. This is so obviously nationalism, sovereignty coming back, and they have conditioned people that having sovereignty and having fair trade deals is racist, and that Donald Trump wants to screw brown people over because he wants to get more jobs in America. It is the death of logic, the death of common sense. So I've got a cornucopia of clips that I'm going to be getting to here, trying to find my video list. It's got notes all over it. Will somebody run me another video list in here until I find it? Thank you. Yeah, we're going to get to the Clinton implicitly racist clip. Then we're going to play a bunch of other clips dealing with Trump saying, you know, why he's glad that he didn't basically go below the belt, but Hillary did. And I want to give you my take on what really happened at the debate, but also take your phone calls. The toll-free number to join us is 800-259-9231, 800-259-9231. Long-time callers, first-time callers, you agree, you disagree, 800-259-9231. We'll also go more into the open fraud that we witnessed last night. Briefly, the sale ends at the end of the show today when it comes to Super Male Vitality and Super Female Vitality. We must end the special. I've extended it for basically a week. It ends at the end of the broadcast today. It is a bunch of concentrated, known organic herbs associated with boosting vitality, stamina, energy, libido, especially when people notice. You can read the five-star reviews at InfoWarsLife.com or InfoWarsStore.com is the main site. You'll find the subsection, InfoWarsLife.com, link there. We have store-wide free shipping that we're going to run through tomorrow, but then it will end. And that is all part of Americanism versus globalism. This is the Americanism versus globalism, limited time free shipping, celebrating the rise of populism that Trump is only one manifestation of, the rediscovery, or for the first time for many, the discovery of common sense and nationalism. We have free shipping. You can also sign up for auto ship and get an additional 10% off all orders $50 or more. Normally have free shipping, but this is free shipping whether you're buying a, you know, $5 book or whether you're getting a solar generator, whether you're getting an air purifier or water filter. It just doesn't matter. Store-wide free shipping. Secret 12, the methylcobalamin high-quality B12 is taken sublingually. That is 20% off as well. That's going to be ending today. InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsLife.com, or call toll-free 888-253-3139. And several times a day, I take my new probiotic, Biome Defense. I pause because I'm looking for my bottle of it. I had one. I guess we did have a bunch of folks here last night. No, I know it's down here on the floor. I had two bottles of it open. Here's one that was open. People move this around. Sorry. Teleprompter free, folks, because I was going to take some time out to take this. This is 7 years in the making, 5 years that we've been reaching out, but group was already developing it 7 years ago. It's 23 unique, high-quality strains that are seen in the industry as the very best out there. These strains are very, very expensive just to get each one of the strains. And this is sent to you via a little refrigeration pack, a little cold pack. Now, if it gets heated up, it doesn't kill all of it, but it's obviously good to keep it, you know, at 65 degrees or lower, like in your refrigerator. And it's amazing. High-powered InfoWars probiotics have arrived. 50 billion live active cultures, 23 probiotic strains, and it is produced, obviously, in a refrigerated top lab here in the U.S., and then it is shipped to us in a refrigeration truck, and we have a big refrigeration room that we put in that now houses this Biome Defense probiotic. We're very, very proud of it. We could have easily just come out and private labeled one of hundreds of other probiotics that are out there. But they're just not as good. This is the very best over-the-top product. If you go to Whole Foods, they have some similar strains and similar Rolls-Royce quality that are $100, $110, $120. You have some that you get from medical facilities that are $200, $300, $400. This is $68. And believe me, all the costs of refrigeration and the development, that is very inexpensive. This should be $100, $120. This is the very best from our research probiotic you're going to find anywhere. Now, obviously, consult your healthcare provider before you take it. This is all seen as completely safe, but I say consult your doctor before you breathe oxygen, before you drink water, and before you even look at the stars at night. You should consult with the Food and Drug Administration before you walk, before you talk, before you brush your teeth. They are God. But so be sure and consult your healthcare professional. So that's Probiotic Biome Defense, InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsStore.com. Or call toll-free 888-253-3139. Okay, and that is how we fund the operation. I want to thank you all for your support. And let me say something about that, about the debate, before I go any further. I was up here on air for 3.5 hours yesterday. I hosted half of the fourth hour. And then I got prepared for the debate. And then I came up here and I hosted basically 5 hours. Wild horses couldn't drag me away. And some of my points were excellent. Some of my other points were okay, because I get pretty tired by midnight when I've been up since 6 a.m. But the crew, I was watching Fox, watching CNN in their pre- and post-debate when I was taking breaks. They were having audio problems, couldn't go to half their guests. Stuff was cutting out. Their host sounded completely wooden and boring. And you could tell they were all following talking points. And then I was sitting here watching my crew, going to different studios, going to our reporters in New York, going to our reporters on the ground in Austin, and all the things that were happening and how real it was. I was so proud of the crew. I am so proud of the producers, the researchers, the camera people. Everyone here is truly amazing. And it brought me to tears last night. I mean, not like sobbing, but like tears when you see a beautiful sunset, or tears when your wife has a new baby. I mean, just the fact that InfoWars really is special, and that's why I can't stand it when people call in and thank me for what I've done, because I'm kind of the crazy 800-pound gorilla here, hopping up and down to get people out of their mind-numb stupor. But it's the rest of the researchers, the crew, and the entire family of guests and reporters and people we have on that is InfoWars. You are the InfoWar. We are the InfoWar. And quite frankly, I am extremely humble by your support, by your prayers. And instead of getting on a power trip over all this, I want to say weighed down by conscience, by responsibility, and by humility. I want to be clear, because it's embarrassing sometimes. I come off like a very aggressive, angry, arrogant person. And that's not because I'm arrogant. I'm the opposite. But it's because this is so serious, and I have to get hyped up to do this. I'm normally a pretty calm person at home and in my general life. I'm a pretty private person. I don't want to say solitary, but I'm a very private person. And I do this because I understand we're facing evil. And I understand it's dangerous, too. So this is necessity, what we're doing. This is survival. This isn't something you thank me for. Okay? I'm trying to save myself by saving you. You understand that? And I'm not saying it's even selfishness, but people who think it's heroic to fight tyranny, you have to get outside that paradigm. Understand, it's not heroic to pull air into your lungs. It's not work. It's life. It's not heroic to do the right thing. It's what we've got to do. This is history happening. And Donald Trump, I've gone from seeing them attack him and seeing him promote populism and standing up and not being weak and having courage to liking him more than the rest of the Republican field. Then the Republican establishment attacked him, and so I had more support for him. And then I saw his policies get better and better. But now I can tell you, I'm really proud of Donald Trump, and I'm really satisfied and feel good in my gut and my spirit that I have supported him, because you could see him up there like a lion who's been attacked by all these wolves, all these hyenas, all these other creatures of the night, with all the attacks, all the demonization, all the rigging, everything stacked against him, just the archetypal hero. But it isn't even being a hero, it's survival. And understanding he has to do this, and everything they do blowing up in his face. I didn't know what I thought about the debate last night. I said that. I said, I think he won, but narrowly. Hillary kind of got a lot of points because she could stand there. So that was a victory for Hillary. It was rigged, all the attacks. There was a third debater, basically, named Lester Holt. I was very saddened by the fact that I've never seen him behave this way, but you could tell the orders were in. He ran off in an embarrassed way like Judas. But I tell you, by the fact that he did take the high road, I think he did overall have the victory, and the polls across the country show that. But this gets so sophisticated, and it's how I started the debate last night, and 45 minutes before 8 o'clock, at about 7:15, 7:20, I came on after the news package, and I said, listen, please listen to me carefully. And I'm going on these clips and your calls. I said, Donald Trump, the system will say Donald Trump won if he goes in there and acts establishment, because really what he's showing them is he's going to play ball and go along, and it's the beginning of the sellout. If he goes in there and is focused, not hateful, but aggressive, and really nails her to the wall, that will be the big victory against the media trying to bully Trump into submitting and doing what they want. And then they're going to say he won if he goes in and plays along with it. But Donald Trump did something really, really special last night. He transcended all of that. They bullied him, they rigged it, they attacked, they twisted, and he still hit her with some hard points, but did it in a very measured way, and so it blew up in their face, And so many Democrats I know and so many people that were on the fence, and the polls show it, are now going to Trump because they saw how rigged it was. And at their base humanity, seeing someone in the arena surrounded 100-1 with the foreign governments and the big banks and the billionaires and the media and all those vampires hating him because he's alive, he has a soul. All the sellouts wanting to bring him down, wanting to destroy him, because they know they failed, because he represents the human spirit that refuses to submit to tyranny. And so Donald Trump is our champion now. And he's inexorably tied to the fate of this republic, just as all of us are, but to a greater extent. And so he won the debate big time last night. I've really pulled back. I've looked at it. I've thought about it. But he has to go into the next one and just say, look, I'm just here to tell the truth. I'm not going to play games. They rigged the last debate. I got interrupted 40 times. This better not be rigged. Just get that out up front. Not being a sore loser. He's pointing out that he won, even though it was rigged. Don't try it. The American people saw it. Reach out to the American people. The people of the world say, we all saw what happened. Don't try it now at Fox, at the next debate, and just roll over these people. That's what's got to be done. But Trump won the debate. He won it big time. Now, let's go to a clip of Hillary invoking race, and then I want to go to a clip of Trump saying he's glad that he took the high road. But here's Hillary invoking race.
Do, and we ought to do it in a bipartisan way.
Secretary Clinton, last week you said we've got to do everything possible to improve policing, to go right at implicit bias. Do you believe that police are implicitly biased against black people?
Lester, I think implicit bias is a problem for everyone, not just police. I think, unfortunately, too many of us in our great country jump to conclusions about each other. And therefore, I think we need all of us to be asking hard questions about, you know, why am I feeling this way? But when it comes to policing, since it can have literally fatal consequences, I have said in my first budget, we would put money into that budget to help us deal with implicit bias.
Yeah, but what about implicit bias in people that have other skin colors as well? I mean, we're all humans. We have brains that are basically the same, person to person, they vary. That, I mean, you can have totally racist black people or Hispanics or whatever. Again, it's this idea that white people and cops are inherently after black folks, and in some cases that's true, but not across the board. And then statistically, we know that it's very rare for black people to be killed by the police, statistically. The media takes every case and hypes it up like a great white shark attack, okay? But it's not reality-based. InfoWars Live, host Alex Jones. Paul Watson's hosting the fourth hour, nightly news tonight, 7 o'clock Central. All right, John disagrees in California. I'm going to go to him first. Then Scott in the Netherlands, because he's calling from overseas. And then James, Garrett, Steve, and many others. But again, we're going to be taking your calls right through to the end of the third hour. And then Paul Watson, obviously, will always have a lot of devastating analysis and information. A lot more is breaking. Lester Holt, the third debater, I'm looking at drudgereport.com, asked Trump 6 follow-up questions, did not ask any of Clinton, interrupted Trump 40-plus times, interrupted Hillary 7. We've got some of these clips boiled down where it really shows how nasty Holt got towards the end. And you could tell Holt ran off. Obviously, he had an earpiece. I believe he was being told, go after Trump, go after Trump. Your job's on the line. This is high stakes, folks. This is 21st century information war. We know it's all rigged. He showed that. And I believe Holt was very embarrassed, because I don't think Holt's a bad guy. I don't get a bad feeling about him. I like a lot of his reporting. I'm rarely wrong. I thought he'd be a lot fairer, like Matt Lauer was. And he still leaned towards Clinton, too. Man, you know the country's in trouble. When they just lean a little bit for Clinton, you're happy. But he was just... This was a boxing match. Hillary had horseshoes loaded into her gloves. I'm going to go to your calls right now. John in California, you disagree. Go to the head of the line. Go ahead, John.
Hi, Alex. I just want to preface this. I've been a listener for 20 years. Listening to the debate last night, the hair on the back of my neck stood up. I cannot get past Trump's stop and frisk policy, clear violation of our Fourth Amendment rights.
Great point.
We have to hold his feet to the fire on this, Alex. He has to come out and say he will defend and support the Constitution. I do not hear that out of him, and it's cause for concern.
Let me just say this. You're absolutely on target, and I should spend an hour on this or do a special report just explain my view on it. Trump is an old-school tough guy, and he's in New York. He saw the incredible crime, and what they do is they target people that look like they're dressed like gang members or whatever, and it can be racial profiling, and it's terrible. But you know what? It made the crime go way down because the gang culture is so out of control. I don't care if you're white kids with your drawers hanging down or black kids. The cops would do it, and it is a police state. But then when the globalists come in and destabilize the country and things are falling apart, what do? Just let people run around killing everybody like in Chicago? So when you're in a martial law situation, they've brought Chicago into a collapse. So then at some point, it's going to go under martial law. I'm not for that. Just like they bring the radical Muslims in, and it causes Europe to be destabilized, then they bring in a civil emergency. I said it would happen. I don't want the martial law, but what are they supposed to do? So, again, it's a very complex issue. It's like Trump on torture. He goes, we're doing it. It's already going on. Yeah, we're going to torture ISIS. They're bad guys. There's a disconnect. But Trump sees himself as good. So he thinks, I'm only going to torture ISIS that murder Christians. Well, you can't do that. But he believes it from the place he's coming. I get the logic. So he's being honest. It's almost a plus, even though I don't support it. But do you see the nuance of what I'm saying?
Alex, I do, but it's a slippery slope.
I agree. Listen, I agree. What outweighs it 50-1 is the true evil elite that put cancer viruses in vaccines, that are changing the human genetic code, that are mutilating the planet, that are spraying aluminum dioxide in the sky. They hate this guy. Because despite his little problems, we all got them, they are pure evil and they hate him. But the truth is, his honesty about it almost makes it okay, but it's not. I agree with you. It's something we got to work on. But we're going to get a lot better stuff out of Trump being close to him than we're going to be fighting him. But I, you know what? I want to give you a comeback to that. It's too heavy. All right. If you just tuned in, we're taking your phone calls. We're going to be playing a lot of clips this hour of debate highlights. I think Trump won, not in the way I thought he would. He didn't really roll over, but he just let them rig the whole thing so the whole world could see that it was like watching a bunch of hyenas attack a lion. But I think in the next debate, he's got to come in and savage her on her lies. And, you know, now he's been chivalrous. You know, he's let her play the lady card. We're taking your phone calls right now on this. John disagreed, you know, saying that he thought the debate was bad for Trump because he got into stop and frisk. And this is Hillary with overthrowing countries, murdering Christians en masse. You know, NSA spying, all this Bill of Rights trampling. And then he's there saying, hey, stop and frisk lowered crime by unbelievable amounts. I mean, we're talking like 90-something percent. But hundreds of thousands of people, more than half of them being black. You're walking down the street and the cops just pull over and frisk you, sometimes on a weekly basis. I would get pissed off. I'd say to the cops, do I look like an all-points bulletin? Do I hold on, officer, do I look like somebody? Because if you're saying you're looking for somebody who looks like me, here's my ID. But if you're just randomly, hey, we're just going to search everybody on the street, that is not America. But then the community jump up and down and say we had, you know, 5 kids shot this week in this one neighborhood. And that's because of the gangbanger culture. But the caller is right. It's a slippery slope. And then I'm going to go to Scott in the Netherlands and others. But, John, you want to respond to what I said earlier?
I do, and I partially agree, but we cannot afford to give up any more liberty for security.
I totally agree with you.
Given us the Patriot Act, the NDAA. We've got to draw the line, and we've got to get Trump to come out and state this, that he will support and defend our constitutional rights.
You're right. All right, thank you. Good point. By the way, there's a story up on Infowars.com. We pointed this out in 2004. At the debates, it's something we've gone over, that Bush was wearing some type of earpiece, wireless earpiece that had the transmitter booster on his back, and it appears that Hillary had something snaked up her suit as well. Just saying. And she does need help now when people tell her stuff in her ear routinely. We have video of it. So she definitely becomes uncognizant at certain points and goes in and out of consciousness. Scott in the Netherlands, thank you for calling. What did you think about the debate?
Good morning or good afternoon, Alex. My girlfriend and I, we got up 2 o'clock in the morning to watch your show and watch the debates. And my girlfriend, I mean, she's Dutch and she's not really into the politics, but she thought it was pretty balanced as far as them playing off each other. I think both of us were in the same scenario as many of the other listeners are. We were all kind of half betting to see if she was going to be able to stand up for the entire hour and a half debate. So, I mean, I think a lot of us had, you know, side bets going, is she going to pass out, yes or no? And I think that was one of the reasons maybe that he was going easy on her just in case something like that was going to happen. Well, I was just disappointed that there were so many of the easy points that he could fire back at her rhetoric. And what I'm really hoping, because you say that sometimes you have like the inside baseball that maybe between Roger Stone and even if it's David Knight or yourself, that you could actually take the time to help coach him. Cause I know
I've talked to Donald Trump one time on air and talked to him some other times, and I'm just going to leave it at that. But I mean, it's, look, I mean, I think Donald Trump's as smart as I am or smarter. I'm certainly, when you're the man in the arena, it's really hard. I mean, look, he does read people's tweets. He does pick up what's on the show. His sons, you know, I know, tune in and retweet a lot of our stuff. I mean, what would you like to say to Donald Trump? When we come back, Scott in the Netherlands, stay there. What your message to Donald Trump? What you think? And again, I'm taking calls that disagree up front, so it's not just a cheering section here. We'll go to James and Garrett and Ken and Steve and Kent and everybody else straight ahead, 800-259-9231. Stay there, Scott. We are 41 days out from the November historic election. September 2016 is long in its tooth. Hard to believe we're about to go into 2017. With the British Ministry of Defense in 2007 and the Defense Department in 2007 as well, predicting that by the end of 2016, we would enter a global financial meltdown peaking in 2024. And we are in an engineered economy. They're bringing in global government. Obama last week at the UN called for us to waive sovereignty and enter a, quote, liberal new world order. Liberal world order. Order. The term world order or new world order was first introduced in 1937 on the world stage by Adolf Hitler. But the term actually came from the Fabian Socialists in 1901. And the leader of the Fabian Socialists and the World Futurist Society, H.G. Wells, who in 1899 wrote about atomic bombs and the equations. Why do I mention that? Because whatever plan you're hearing about today is very old, and the technocrats have theoretical understanding of technology. They say 30 years ahead, but if they've already jumped with Lord knows what's been discovered, that's why they're so arrogant now. They have Promethean fire, that they could be 1,000 years ahead of us. I mean, theoretically, they're acting really weird, okay? Like we're just a problem, spilt blood or something on the ground that's got to be cleaned up. And the Google people run around saying, you're like bugs if you don't assimilate in the new corporate. We might step on, you know, we might not, you know? So there's this backdrop going on, and Trump had to basically come in. And according to, I guess, the view he went with, and look presidential and not look like a bully. But you're on the stage with an evil bully. So the facts trump all of that standard societal popery. I mean, I think that you've just got to transcend it. But it blew up in their face, not because he was so nice, but because it was so staged, with Lester attacking more and more towards the end as he realized that Trump had won. And Hillary, you know, going from the little old lady to getting a little bit nastier and, you know, flashing her little demon eyes. Wasn't fair. Donald Trump was up against two people. So he won because it was clearly staged. They forfeit and it blew up in their face. And then just the icing of him laying back while they destroyed themselves, I guess, shows some mental judo, mental jujitsu. That you have to admire the depth of the great orange toad. Now, that said, I want to go back to Scott in the Netherlands, who was saying that, you know, he was disappointed that we're going to hurry through a bunch of calls here. Again, we're taking calls that disagree up front. I think Trump won the debate, not in the way I thought he would, but I really thought about it. What is your message to Donald Trump, Scott?
Well, my personal message to Donald Trump is that we need a real constitutionalist. We need to have somebody who's going to follow the United States Constitution, and then hammer Hillary. It's not that hard. I mean, she has so many faults. We got Benghazi. We've got the Clinton Foundation. I mean, these were so easy slam dunks that he could have just creamed her with
I understand, but listen. Here's the problem. You're educated, you're informed. And so from your perspective, and I think you're probably right, you have to let the, you know, message rise to the occasion to actually inform the public and not just dumb it down, saying the public's dumb. That's why they're dumb, because the message has been dumbed down. It's not the other way around. I agree. You put out the complex info, and you actually address people like they've got a brain, they will pick it up fairly quickly. And so I think it was the wrong move. I said before the debate, if he comes out and does softballs and acts too nice because she's a woman, just because that's what the establishment says will be a win, it will not be as big a win as is he really runs over her and calls her out. But the polls show all over the country, and they're scientific, that he won over a bunch of Democrats last night who are like children. So see, I argue on one side, then I argue on the other. I mean, I think the proof will be in the pudding in November. What do you think?
I have my fingers crossed. I mean, it's still, you still have voter fraud and everything else that's going on with it, and that's a nightmare for anybody.
Well, the Goblin King, and of course that's Michael Moore, the man that has six bodyguards and says you shouldn't be able to have a gun, he says Trump won the debate, hands down. And yeah. He said Hillary was too classy to go for the jugular. Hillary is anything but classy. She is a grasping white trash monster. I appreciate your call, Scott. Let's go now to, let me see who's been holding the longest here. Let's go ahead and talk to Steve in Colorado. You're on the air. Go ahead.
Yes, Alex. This is, I'm a first-time caller, a long-time listener. I was watching the debates last night, and I was watching, it was around the end of the debate when Trump was walking off the stage. He didn't look like he was happy. Like, he looked like he was kind of sort of distraught a little bit. Like
he looked distracted when he was talking to the media. Deal. Absolutely. He looked like he wasn't being himself. He looked like he had to pull his horns in, and I don't think he enjoyed it.
Well, no, not at all. I think he really did want to go after Hillary really big time, but his advisors must have told him not to, but he should have just went after her. So now it sort of looks like Hillary has the stronger lead, even though she's a liar. But it kind of looked like Hillary was stronger last
No, time. I agree. I mean, he's been surging in all the polls. He's continued to surge after this. Time will tell. And again, we have to look at each poll and see if they're scientific. But overall, it appears it was a victory, but not a stunning victory, not a devastating, you know, the powder keg in the magazine of the ship blows up and it goes, you know, 1,000 yards in the air. Not spectacular, but more of a ship listing on its side, slowly going beneath the waves. But we've got fires on our own ship, Steve. Anything else?
Well, you know, I just want Donald Trump to go ahead and make America great again. I think he really can do this with the support of the American people. We need to get that out there that Hillary Clinton is nothing but a fraud. So we need to get that out there.
All right, my friend, thank you so much. Let's go ahead now and take another call. Let's talk to Garrett in Texas. You're on the air.
Hey, Alex. I've been listening for several years. I'm 16,
And you know what? I think that Trump won the debate. I think that he was definitely a whole lot stronger than Hillary was. But at the same time, I agree with them on the fact that throughout his entire campaign, I noticed that he never really seemed as constitutional as, like, for example, someone like Rand Paul, who I supported before. But he's definitely a supporter of the First and Second Amendment. But
elites are going after him. He wants to get the foreign bank that runs our country, the Federal Reserve, out of here. He wants to reform that and change that. He wants to end the bad trade deals. We've been captured by foreign globalists. He does support private property. He does support the Second Amendment. And then he's saying, if you're a globalist or an outsider, you're not an American, you don't get those rights. That's really what Trump's saying. Or he's saying, and it's one of the only elitist things he does, if you're in a bad neighborhood and there's a bunch of crime, we're just going to knock some heads and clean things up. And again, the honesty's good, but the way it's being done will be twisted and used against us. So in the negative column, he's got some problems. The positive column is 10 times better. So that's where I stand.
Of course. Yes, if he's in there, and you know what, if this election is fair, he will be, because these people are saying that Hillary's ahead. Trump has more votes than any Republican in history.
That's right. Well, I have all the polls here. I mean, look at the interest. You know, they're saying as big as the Super Bowl last night, as the early numbers come in, looks like it's gonna be the biggest thing ever. People are super interested. They're upset. He's populist. He's outside the normal political ring. The power structure is panicking for a reason. He is coming after him. He wants to act like a president. The perfect constitutionalist, no. But an American for America who isn't out to get us and who also doesn't want to start random evil wars. You know, I mean, he's really good on a lot of fronts, and he's bad on a couple. Look at Hillary. We know what we've got over there is much worse. And it's not a lesser of two evils. She's a globalist. She is a hijacker. When I say they're collaborators, when I say we've been taken over by foreign power, that's what the New World Order is a global corporate takeover of nation states, the family, and everything else. I appreciate your call, Garrett. We've got Kent in Oregon just popped up. He disagrees. I'll go to him first, and then I will go to Sean, who's a Democrat, says he's voting for Trump. Wants to talk about Lester Holt. We've got James in South Carolina, wants to talk about the debates. John in Wyoming says no mention of Benghazi. Yeah, that's a big problem, and we better hear about Benghazi in the next debate. We better hear about that when she's bringing up, you know, all the, you know, terrible things and how Trump didn't want to take care of our military and how he's greedy and, you know, how he's mean to a guy in the audience who was an architect who didn't get paid what he originally wanted to and all this other bull. I would have said, you're telling me about some architect and a fight over the bill when you're the lady that ordered the stand down at Benghazi and said, what difference does it make? You got a lot of nerve, lady. He just sat there and let her stab him and stab him and stab him and stab him. But I guess it blew up in their face because everybody saw how rigged it was. I don't know. It's very complex. When I say that my head's spinning, there's so much to cover. I saw this morning, I read it, and then I kind of put it in the back of my mind because I wanted to try to reach out to Michael Savage, and I've got his cell phone number in my phone right here. So I'm just so bad about it. I don't even know if I saved it under his name or it's in my computer. I used to talk to him a lot more on the phone. He's busy. I'm busy. We just don't talk as much as a few years ago. We talked quite a bit. I'm not bragging about it. I'm just saying I need to call Michael Savage. That's why I'm not talked about it yet, because I don't know how much I can say. Because the last few times I talked to him a few weeks ago before he came on air twice to promote his new book, he specifically told me about censorship going on and that he was getting really pissed off. And obviously, he didn't say that's off record, but any conversation I have with Savage, I mean, I've had like hour-long conversations with him before, is off record. And so this just hit me. They were asking me, hey, why aren't you covering this? And I'm like, covering what? Oh, yeah, the Michael Savage thing. It just becomes so surreal. Like, oh, you're under investigation by the Justice Department to see if you're going to come after Hillary. It's like, It's surreal. I would never hurt Hillary Clinton. And I don't say that because I'm afraid they're coming to get me. I don't say that because, you know, if I thought going after Hillary would be a good idea, I would say it. But I'm afraid they're going to get me. No, I think it's a bad idea. She's a horrible person. It would turn her into a martyr. But at the same time, I get sick of the stinking criminals in this government. They're the ones running around committing all these crimes, constantly getting in my life, going after my friends, screwing everyone over, and trying to take our liberties. I'm tired of it. I have a right to not be your slave. And I can tell you, part of the censorship is talking about InfoWars.com and playing clips of our reporters on air. I can tell you that. I'm just going to say it. But get Savage's phone number dialed up on here for me, guys. I'll call him during the break. But that's the kind of stuff I'm dealing with, and I got all these clips to play, and I've got all these guests to get on, and I'm not complaining. It's just, this is so real, people. This is not a game. This is not the average talk show host that takes it easy and doesn't push the envelope. There's only one other talk show host that does it to the level we do it, and it's Michael Savage. And hundreds of affiliates down the tube. I mean, I hope this doesn't happen. Because we need Michael Savage on the air. And if you just tuned in, I'll tell you what's going on. Popular radio host Michael Savage broadcast shut down nationwide as he discusses Clinton's health. And that's the big censorship, is you do not discuss Hillary's health on mainstream outlets. That is the big no-no. And obviously, he's getting censored. I mean, if he told me, without me even asking to come on, that he wants to play clips of my show and that he wants to, you know, have Paul Watson on and he wants to play our reports, it'd be every day, by the way, if he could. They're like, no, you're not going to. And by the way, I've told Savage, cut my name out. Cut Paul's out. We don't care. He goes, no, I'm going to give you credit. So the point is, I raise this because I guarantee you, InfoWars is in the middle of this. I was talking to Savage about it last week. Michael Savage is a very well-known radio talk show personality. This is Breitbart. This is the last refuge. Will you guys give me the Breitbart article? And then it goes on. The Savage Nation is a nationally syndicated talk show. It's the second most listened to radio talk show in the country with an audience of over 20 million listeners, 400 stations. Earlier today, he was discussing his perspectives on the presidential debate, giving examples of current and anticipated debate bias. In addition, the broadcaster began discussing Hillary Clinton's mysterious health condition that Savage believes might be Parkinson's. Almost immediately, without any notification, New York tri-state radio station WABC Radio TV cut Savage off the air and replaced him with a lesser-rated Curtis and Kuby show. He tweeted, I've been sabotaged on air to destroy support for Trump. More later. And then now reportedly, shortly thereafter, Savage disavowed, discovered the issue and began discussing what was going on in and around the New York broadcast area. All Savage affiliates nationwide cut off the broadcast and replaced the live transmission with a recording of the previous show. I mean, how real is that? We told you they're coming after talk radio. We told you they're going to shut us down. I told you, canaries in the coal mine, Drudge, Savage, InfoWars. Yours truly, and not that Limbaugh's perfect, but they want to get him big time. And I'm telling you, man, this is bad news. And then I don't even say I'm exhausted about this. It's just like, as a journalist, I'm not even happy that I can call Savage up and find out, get the scoop. You know, it's like hearing about a death in the family to know how much trouble this country's in, folks. Michael Savage, I can't believe how calm the media is about this. Pulled off the airwaves live on WABC, biggest station in the country, hands down. Top-rated show. Number two show in the country. Probably bigger than Limbaugh. But it doesn't matter. He's pulled live in New York and replaced with another show because he's talking about Hillary's health, saying he believes she has Parkinson's. Her emails that DC Leaks got has her talking about Parkinson's medication. That's in WikiLeaks as well. And then he's pulled off the air. So the real headline here is national talk show host pulled during live show for talking about Hillary's health. This isn't like Dr. Drew fired a week later from CNN. This is in live time. So they pull him off WABC. He starts ranting about it and tweeting, I've been sabotaged, and they cut him live from the 400 other affiliates across the country. Top-rated talk show host Michael Savage pulled off air after discussing Hillary's health. And a week ago, I mean, he was on Skype during the break. The whole crew was there. He was talking about, hey, can you guys get me this interview on air today? But I'm not sure I can air it. They've been trying to keep me from airing your stuff. Now I've got to go through CBS. And there you go. Boom. A week later, Michael Savage is off the air. He said pure sabotage. And Matt Drudge was here a year ago and said it's coming 2016. I was told by the Supreme Court justice, the other conservative one, you know, the other one died. And the Washington Post came out a month later and said he was part of a secret society connected to Bohemian Grove. Just to throw it all in our face. In case there's a contested election, you'll have a locked 4-4 Supreme Court. Well, you can really see them pulling out the stops. And they... Let me just explain something. I know I am in real, palpable crosshairs of the New World Order. I'm not even afraid, but it is definitely... You can feel it. And this country is... And make no mistake, keeping your head down is how we're going to lose the whole enchilada. We have Larry Nichols. And he's just popping in for a few minutes, and I promise I'm going to run through James and Lisa and Matt and Terry and Sean, your response to the debate, Lester Holt running off like a rat after, very, very shameful. I think Trump overall won by not looking like the bully. But we had Larry on with us just a month ago saying what he thought he should do. I thought he barely won last night, but I slept on it, and I came out and I saw the polls saying he's getting a lot of Democrats to swing over just by looking like a nice guy. In the fact that he let them gang up on him, and took it very coolly, and then Holt got madder and madder and lost his cool. In the last third, really showed his colors, interrupting Trump 40-plus times. Never asking counter questions, not once to Hillary, 40-plus times. And then only, quote, fact-checked her 7. Amazing. Amazing. So you total that up together, that's almost 50 times he went after Trump. For 7 on Hillary, and only one of those, no, it was 6, only one of those 6 times was it a real question. My head, again, was swimming, more than spinning. I mean, last night when I was covering it live, trying to only a brief analysis, it was just all lies. It was incredible. So we're going to be breaking all that down. I haven't even gotten all the clips yet. It's going to be a jam-packed third hour, obviously, but the clips are up on Infowars.com. Hillary, the one time she told the truth, said, I'm coming after your guns. No more due process. Extrajudicial. We'll just put you on a list and take your guns. Just as we feel like you're a threat. Because the Justice Department just says so. Kind of like Michael Savage and thousands of others now are banned from flying to England because they were just put on a list. And now the new mayor says he wants to establish Sharia law. Wants to censor free speech and has set up a speech czar this week in London who will arrest people that criticize Islam. Boy, isn't that great in the birthplace of Magna Carta and codified free speech. Before we go any further, we have free shipping that is going to end tomorrow. I mean, it's going to end tonight. I don't know. I might extend that because I'm cut off the Supernova Vitality. Officially ended yesterday, but it's still in the shopping cart. 20% off. The methylcobalamin, super high quality vitamin B12, secret 12. That's 20% off. Free shipping store wide as part of the Americanism, not globalism special. And we've got a lot of other specials as well. We now have a probiotic, 7 years in the making. This was being produced, being developed and tested 2 years before I even got into nutraceuticals. This particular formula that the experts we've talked to and the scientists that developed this with Dr. Group say is the ultimate probiotic. For a price half of what leading competitors are. I mean, this is a really Rolls-Royce, Bentley level, Ferrari level, $50 billion live and active cultures, 23 probiotic strains. It's amazing. And it is way, way, way less expensive than the other super high quality versions that are out there. And believe me, with probiotics, you get what you pay for, ladies and gentlemen. InfoWarsLife.com. We could have private labeled hundreds and hundreds of pretty good probiotics, but we wanted to make something ridiculously good. That's why we don't have that many products on our line, because I could go out and private label 100 different, you know, high quality products that are, you know, pretty darn good. But we've only private labeled of our close to 30 products now, maybe 10 of those are private labeled, which are known high quality. Take Child Ease. That is another best-selling 30-plus year brand. It's basically a syrup of all these herbs and echinacea and everything else that calms your child. And it's just a private label of the top-selling brand in the country. So there's stuff that's already game-changer, amazing stuff out there. We just go private label that and then try to discount it. But most of our products we have now developed in-house with top developers, not just in concert with the group, but he also advises us. And, I mean, Child Ease is something kids should take every day. It doesn't have anything in them to actually calm them. It just gives them all the vitamins and minerals and key herbs that are associated with kids being healthy, and then they just get calm. This stuff is incredible. I give it to my children in the morning, and it's essential. You know, your kid gets red dye, they bounce off the walls. They drink corn syrup, they bounce off the walls. But imagine what the opposite of that does. That's Child Ease. So you can check out the 4.7-star reviews at InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsStore.com, or something called toll-free 888-253-3139. There's a lot of products I never talk about that are really excellent at InfoWarsLife.com. But regardless, we need the funds to continue. I don't want to risk my life, my treasure, my name, and everything to lose. I know we can win, but the stakes are so high. You can feel the energy. It's gone from intense to over the top to crazy to unprecedented to now the energy level so high, it's almost like things are dead silent. It's just, I mean, it is incredible, because Trump is just a manifestation of nationalism and humanity awakening, and the globalists are panicking, and it is just an incredible time to be alive. So thank you for your prayers, your support, watching our six, our human element of patriots out there that always give us good information. I can't believe how good the information has been. Not to kiss the military and police's butts, who I've been big critics of when they do bad things, obviously, but just comparing the military and police and people even in high government areas that are patriots compared to the general public that is pretty much brain dead in many cases is amazing. It is patriots in the government that have been trying to stop this takeover forever. And that's why the globalists want a civil war where we have a war with the federal government. The federal government's been captured, folks. We need to identify the globalists and not have the civil war. That's why they're trying to sell a narrative that I want a civil war and I want violence. They sell it in the media. They sell the Southern Poverty Law Center, the ADL. They sell it behind the scenes. They try to set us up because they cannot stand the fact that we are effectively kicking their butt. And listen, I'm on GCN, a small network. It's basically a satellite provider. So I went and chose a satellite provider. So it's not, you know, they have a little bit of affiliate relations, stuff like that, but it's very mom and pop. It's actually the third biggest network out there. 2,000 plus affiliate agreements, 1,400 affiliates. I don't have that, but you know, that's how many affiliates GCN has, and it's literally run, you know, out of a small facility in Minnesota. And that's because this is my show. I say what I want. I do what I want. I'm not controllable. And that's why they don't know what to do. I mean, because I'm just an American, and I didn't realize that most generals didn't actually read 500 history books like I have. I didn't realize most people hadn't read 15 books just on the Nazi secret police. And I don't mean little ones. I mean the big, big giant jumbos, okay? I mean, I didn't realize growing up that I just found that interesting. I was drawn to it. I was drawn to those things, and that I, as a lay person, am trained basically in all this stuff. But I don't use the deception I've researched against people. I use it to understand the enemy and see where they're going. And they're just completely freaked out. I mean, I know their methods. I know their operations. Like, I was born to it. I'd up one side and down the other. I've forgotten more than the average person high level in the CIA even knows. And I'm not bragging. It's just a fact. I'm a natural. And they don't know what to do. I'm not bragging. I mean, you know, the fact that I'm a goofball, too, it just adds the whole final touch to it. I'm real. And they don't know what to do, folks, because I'm an American. I'm a Texan. I'm a Christian. I'm a father. I'm not going to roll over. I'm not a hero. I can't get on my knees and roll over dead. I just can't do it. You need to stop yourselves. You need to back off. You need to stop all the wars you're starting. You need to stop funding radical Islamists to kill Christians all over Africa and the Middle East. And then you smirk about it. You people are evil. And look, a lot of them are totally divorced from God, so I can't get through to them. I'm going to go to Larry Nichols right now, a little bit in the next hour. I know he's got to go, though. But there are people serving this evil system who aren't completely given over to evil. Man, get right with God now. Speaking of somebody that got right with God 25 years ago and turned against the Clintons, or 23 years ago, Larry Nichols. Larry, you're on the phone, I know. You're battling for your life, just like this Republic's battling for its life. We pray for you. Hope folks can support you at Nichols Live at AOL.com, at your PayPal there, as you obviously you know, are working hard against the New World Order. Just briefly here, I wanted to get you to pop in. We'll get you back on later in the week or next week for a full hour. What do you think about the debate last night?
Oh, Alex, it was kind of a nothing for what I had hoped we were going to have. But the good news is that Trump was on his game, certainly in the first 20, 30 minutes. And the way that debate's going to break out is it's going to break out the 40% that love Hillary, they think she won. The 40% that hate Hillary or love Trump, they'll think he won. The 20%, that very important 20% that don't care, they probably watched, if they watched it all, Alex, maybe 20 minutes of it till the ball game started. So then they pulled out.
And that's exactly what they're saying, is that that 20% started to come over to Trump. Do you think that's accurate?
You know, let me tell you, after 30 years of Hillary Clinton, this is the battle they're fighting. After 30 years, if people are not committed to Hillary, they're not going to get there. They're not going to get there. If Trump just don't step on his foot, if he just plays straight and plays smart. Now, I was disappointed last night, Alex. You know, they had asked me, I had sent them stuff that they, you know, Trump could have used to draw Hillary into one of her fits of rage. But they didn't. And he should have. He should have.
And by the way, he paused and said, I had a lot of stuff that I was going to bring out.
That's right.
Yeah,
that's right. Now, the thing that was significant, Alex, was what you and I have been trying to say to everybody since day one. It'd be one thing if Donald Trump was running against Hillary Rodham Clinton. That'd be one thing. But he's running against Hillary. He's running against the mainstream media. He was running against the moderator. I mean, you talk about David and Goliath. He was up. You know, he was.
So isn't that why he probably really won, is they overdid it and showed their hand?
You know, if they're, let me tell you, one of the TV networks did a thing where they pulled in 20, quote unquote, non-committed people. And then at the end of the debate, they asked them, now, after this debate, who would y'all vote for? And 18 of them said Hillary. Now, Alex, you and I have been around long enough, maybe the audience hadn't.
That's staged.
The chances of that network pulling in 20 people that were really middle of the road, didn't care, is none. The Clintons chummed that audience. I'm surprised they even let two people say that they were for Trump. But that was all rigged. Everything you see today, folks, please, I beg you.
Oh, CNN admits they sampled almost double more Democrats in their 500-person poll than they did Republicans. I mean, that's absolutely totally skewed right there.
It's skewed, Fungus. That, folks, everything you see on the mainstream is a lie. You know, when they talk about facts, fact-checking Trump, you notice they didn't fact-check Hillary that much.
They fact-checked Trump 40-plus times and her 6 times.
Well, let me tell you, you want to fact-check Hillary, start with the first time she opens her mouth till the last time she closes it.
The only time she told the truth was saying, I'm going to come after your guns extrajudicially.
Yep. And listen, Alex, I heard you talking about, what's his name, getting pulled off the air.
Michael Savage, live on
Michael
air.
Savage. You know, Alex, you and I have been talking about this day coming for years and years. And I know sometimes people say, well, y'all talk about it, but it never happened. Yes, it does happen, but it takes time to materialize.
Oh, it's just happening like right now. See. I've got them circling around us right now.
Oh, you bet. And let me tell you, come October 1st, folks, it's going to be hard to get news on the internet.
And let's talk about that. But let's just remember, they're bold enough to spend $600 million in the last year alone to try to get cop-killing operations going. We're dealing with hardcore criminals. Everybody better decide which side they're on.
You know, I got tickled last night hearing Hillary talk fondly of her dad's little business making draperies. Did I miss something? And I got this from Bill Clinton. One of the reasons Bill told me he married Hillary was because of her dad, Hugh Rodham. And I said, why, Bill? And he said, well, don't you know? And I said, no, I really don't. He said, well, after Al Capone, Hugh Rodham and Dan Rostenkowski took over the Chicago mob. They were running the Chicago mob, and she says he was just a little drapery maker.
And that's why Hillary always has such a penchant for getting her enemies killed, is because she's Chicago Mafia.
That's why, yeah. Well, folks don't even know that the top families in Texas
were all the former Al Capone heads. I mean, they don't understand Capone ran the whole country. And people just don't know that.
They don't know it. And that's what's killing us, Alex. There is a huge group of people, I guess you call them the millennials. I'm trying to live long enough to tell them. But there's a large group of people, Alex, that don't know the Clintons. And the media's doing extra overtime to make sure people don't know the truth about Bill Clinton and his time in office, that don't know the truth about Hillary. You know, Trump said he felt, you know, he didn't do it because he didn't want to do it in front of Chelsea. My God, what about the women Clinton raped that I covered up for him over? What do you think about those women and their lives?
Oh, I know. I love when he was talking about how he's mean to women. I mean, he could have just come right back with, you're going to tell me about being mean to women with all the stuff you've done, how you covered for Bill. I don't know why he didn't go after her.
Well, and I certainly don't know why he didn't at least bring up the point that when guys like Larry Nichols and these women were coming out back during your husband's administration, if you care so much about women and women's issues, why did you personally lead the bimbo eruption?
All right, let's talk about what you expect to happen next. What do you should do in the next debate? We got 41 days to the election. Larry Nichols is our guest. We'll see if we can say a little bit the next hour. Then I promise your calls, all the clips. Paul Watson's coming up. Stay with us. I don't normally waffle, and I'm not waffling. Because time will tell. We've got to look at the demographics. But I always just go with what I think's right. Because I'm not here to play along with the political system. I'm here to change it and educate people. But if Trump's going for the 20% that are undecided that Larry Nichols always talks about, and they admit that's what they're doing, those are mainly folks that really aren't politically informed, and they just want to see somebody act nice and act friendly and not look so threatening and look more presidential. So I think that's what Trump was trying to do, and I think they would have won the debate because he was too nice if they didn't gang up so bad, and Lester Holt attacking him 40-plus times, Hillary only 6 times, and those weren't even attacks. I think the fact that it was so unlevel, Trump wins because of that, and maybe he's a genius because of that. I just think you got to dance with who brung you. And he should have probably been more aggressive. But time will tell. Larry Nichols with him, taking Michael Savage off the air. And we're going to contact him. I've been busy during the breaks, but I'm going to try to get a hold of him. And all the other censorship going on. I mean, clearly, we're entering an end game. What else are you watching for, Larry?
Well, the main thing I'm watching for is what I've told you before. We're at the actual beginning of the end. And they're closing the loop. They're closing it in tight. And what they're going to do to Trump is going to be terrible. I mean, they're just going to load up on him like you've never seen. Now, if Trump were smart, what he would do, if they're going to do This Is Your Life, going back to Trump's past, he has somehow, Alex, got us shifted on. Hey, you want a real screwed up past? Look at Bill. Look at Hillary. I mean, you've got every kind of crime committed during his administration as governor, every kind of crime committed during his administration with Hillary right there beside him during his presidential administration, so much so that he was impeached. It's amazing. Nobody even brought up the word Hillary. Do you realize your husband was impeached? But they don't bring it up. They don't bring it up. So Trump's got to get himself gathered up. And he's got to try to win that 20% by trying to get that 20% to know the real truth about the Clintons. If you know, let me just tell you something that hurt really bad. When they had the riots and the shooting in North Carolina, the world ended for Hillary. The world ended because as of that moment, all of the stuff about emails, all of the stuff about her health just went away. It just went away. And now she's starting out clean all over again.
That's right, and no, he's got to bring it back. I would have said over and over again, listen, Hillary, you've been part of the power structure. You set up this mess. You're the one that sold the country out. I represent change. Very simple, over and over again. She gets all the big money from the special interest. I get none of it. I'm a populist. You have nothing to lose. Vote Trump.
Well, that, and I'm going to give you all something to really believe in. This is true. Something that you can believe in, I guess the best way to say it. Hillary has spent hundreds of millions of dollars in advertising. Trump has spent virtually nothing in comparison. Yet they are technically tied. Now, what you're going to see, Alex, coming up in the next 46 days or how many days you are, you're going to see 41. You're going to see massive polling manipulation, just like you were talking about.
They're going to put all these fake polls to make it look like he's slipping.
Yep. I mean, and it's all going to come together just like it always does with the Clinton plan, the one that I helped put together for
the broken coalition strategy.
You bet. There it is. Look,
Larry, stay there. Larry, I'm going to do five more minutes with you. Then I promised all the callers I'm going right to you, then all the clips, and then Paul Watson. History is happening. We'll be right back on the other side. Understand, though, even if Trump loses, and I believe he's going to win, we win by injecting real issues and nationalism and exposing the globalists. Stay with us. Hour number three is right ahead. All right, Larry Nichols is going to ride shotgun with us to take calls in the next segment. I'm going to write to your calls at the start of the next segment. Leslie and Matt and Terry and Sean and everybody else. And I've got a bunch of clips. We're going to start getting into them in the next segment as well. But, Larry, I mean, this thing where CNN, I covered it in the last hour, the stories on Infowars.com, sampled 40-something percent Democrat and then 26% Republican. Here's the actual numbers. 41% of the people they sampled were Democrats, 26% Republicans. Then they've also been caught calling independents that are really Democrats. So the sample's even bigger. They did that to give her a 60-something percent win. Every other poll showed her way behind. So explain this to me, because you've been on the inside of this. They had more accurate polls up to the RNC. He gets 10, 15 points ahead. Then they put out a bunch of fake polls. You can go to the methodology and see that it's fake. And they're panicking. And then all of a sudden, he surges back, even against fake polls. That would mean he's probably 10, 15 points ahead. Or correct me if I'm wrong. So why ever ease off the fake polls if they were working? Because they did narrow the gap and create some perception. Why not keep the polls going all the time? Or is he really just way ahead of her?
Well, Alex, what happens? Well, first, let me finish what I was saying. The thing to believe in is exactly that she spent hundreds of millions, he spent virtually nothing, and they're technically dead heat if he's not even ahead. So that ought to tell you, Alex, you and programs like yours have just done an incredible job to absorb the people out there that know something's wrong. Now, remember the 20%. Here's what the Clintons know. They know that that 20% in about 10 days is going to start making its mind up. Most of them, believe it or not, will make it up about a week before the campaign and before the election. And what they always do, what you can count on, is they're going to go, the undecided or don't care people, they're going to vote with the last poll they see, and because they don't like to think, Alex, that they're wasting their vote.
They want to bet on a winner.
You got it. There it is. And then Hillary's problem, you mentioned the broken coalition, folks. Broken coalition is something we set up years ago, realizing that the blacks didn't have enough votes to win, the queers didn't have enough to win, the hippies. But when you put them all together, you got enough to win. Well, Hillary was soft with the blacks. They don't like her. They're not turned on by Hillary. And that was what was scaring them. Well, out of the blue comes Charlotte, North Carolina, and they're going to use it to galvanize the blacks, you see. Now, I'm not saying they caused it. I'm just saying.
Sure,
just,
absolutely. But I mean, that's what Soros admits in his emails. That's the plan.
Mm-hmm. I mean, look, Soros is paying these agitators to come into these places when these things occur.
Oh, they admit we have video. It's buses come in.
Yeah, that's what it's about. That's what it's about. If they can fire up the black community over this White Lives Matter, whatever, if they can fire them up, they're hoping they can motivate them, Alex, to come out and vote at least.
Can't the American people break through the mind control and see the rigging? I mean, I think that happened. Polls show that he's actually boosted by this debate.
The thing that's happening, Alex, that I've been waiting for years. In America, we've got a problem. We don't seem to get energized or get involved until something hits us in the pocketbook, personally. Well, it's hitting people now. People are seeing it. It's real. It's in their bank account or it's not in their bank account. So more and more people are waking up and saying something's not right. They haven't been attentive, so they don't know what it is exactly, but they know something's not right.
And InfoWars and Drudge and Savage and you and others are there. So we're getting big. The old media is dying, and they're That's panicking, right. and they want to shut us down. So if they just shut Savage off, I guess I'm next, huh?
You will be. You will be, Alex. And I'm worried about October 1st for you. That's what I worry about.
Yeah, let's talk about that and go to phone calls and come back. They are handing us over to the internet, and they say that the censorship's already massively increasing. I'm not saying it's going to happen overnight. They're going to misrepresent that next week, say that we said, oh, look, the internet's still here. They said it wouldn't be. That, you watch. You will hear that next week. You watch. That's how they change the subject. I'm going to be honest with you. Studying history, living a lot, seeing a lot of things, and then looking at our current straits, we have a very dangerous elite that are out of touch, that are mismanaging things, that are using old systems of control that are basically built into the population. But then the elite can't control themselves, and they are escalating the world towards financial and cultural and military ruin. And that's pretty much agreed to now across the board by top analysts. What we talk about now is, quite frankly, passé. But I'll tell you, in this climate, I'm just getting right with God, and I'm just giving it all to God, because when you actually deal with these people and you live in the trenches fighting them, you just ask yourself, man, how did this universe produce trash like this? And these people are out to get us, folks. They are BAD people. They are loathsome. And I was thinking about this morning, I'm so sick of looking at Hillary Clinton. I'm sick of these criminals invading my life. You know, if I got bad neighbors, I can move. Or if somebody turns out to be a bad person, I stop associating with them. They're not in my life. You know, you got some horrible husband or wife, and you divorce them. Hey, that means I don't ever talk to you again. Bye-bye. But that's not the case with politicians. And these elites and these people, Mark Cuban, hopping around looking like a demon. Hillary, they're animated by just these crazy power trips. And they're dangerous. And they want to run our lives. We're on your calls right now with Larry Nichols. He's going to ride shotgun with us for much of the hour, popping in, giving his take on things. Really expert take. The guy's really smart, obviously. So we're going to talk about stuff with callers. Michael Savage, it's like a punch in the stomach this morning. I got up and learned he was taking off WABC, and then he complained about it. He was criticizing Hillary's health, you know, saying, I think she's got Parkinson's. There's emails that say she's got getting Parkinson's medication, in her own email. They took him off WABC, and then he complained about it on air. They took him off 400-plus other stations. And, you know, this is personal to me because he was just on air with us last week on Skype. I mean, right here in the studio on that TV, I was talking to him during the breaks. And he was really, I wasn't trying to eavesdrop even before he got on during a 3-minute break, but he was talking in front of us, you know, about what was going on to his assistant. And then he brought it up to me, and I'm just sitting there hearing this. And so it's not like even cool. You know, it's like upsetting. This is military stuff. This is real. This is our country in trouble with controlled media. And Dr. Drew being fired for daring say Hillary needs help in a loving way. This is dangerous. This is dangerous when the press goes along with this and is like, yay, Michael Savage is off the air. Yee, yippee, woo. We're all in lockstep, screwing over everyone. Oh, they're getting ready to take your bank accounts, to ditch the dollar. They're gearing up for martial law, admittedly. They're bringing in the most hardcore, dangerous jihadis. Definitely a sleeper cell invasion. And I'm just sitting back now going, I think stuff's worse than I even thought. They're just announcing you're not going to have cars within 5 years. We're going to take all these big roads and make them driverless car only and ha, ha, ha. And I've got an article here. I'm going to pull it out. Hillary has 99%+ of big corporate giving. It's never before happened. The billionaires and the elite are giving nothing to Trump. I mean, that is the certification of he's our man. You don't like this ruling class? These people are throwing the kitchen sink at Donald Trump right now. I don't know. They're both bad. And exactly what Larry Nichols just said. I'm going to your calls. 20% don't care who gets in. They want to feel like they're a winner. Like when you know your team's going to the Super Bowl and they've got better odds to win, and so you go out and buy a jersey. In fact, they were never your team. You just want to feel like you're a winner. These people are horrible. And there's a sick side of me that sits back and goes, I'm not stupid. I'm going to be pretty much okay in this situation, no matter what happens, because I know what's going on. The only danger I'm in is trying to save all these idiots. I can go off and just run a moral business somewhere and make more money than I make now. I mean, I can do it. I've proven it. I've been paid $800,000+ for one voiceover. I mean, I can do cartoons, movies, you name it. I can do. I'm not bragging, but I can walk away right now. And I can do national voiceovers and have no employees, but I don't do it because it's totally empty. But then I sit, look at snot-nosed, arrogant people that don't care attacking me and our guests and people that are valiantly fighting and just sitting there like everything's a big joke, and it makes me want to throw up. We're going to James and Leslie and Matt and Terry and Sean right now. I'm going to skip this network break so we have more time to get to everybody in this segment, because who knows, there may even be a show soon. I mean, I'm being honest with you folks. This country's in a lot of trouble right now. And it's so real now, it's almost like a joke. It's like I'm up there at the gallows with a rope around my neck and the public's, you know, picking their nose out there, thinks it's all funny when they're going to be marched up here next. And at a certain point, it's just like, wow, this really sucks. But the good news is we've pushed them so hard, they're having to pull people off the radio. Because they know Trump's really way ahead of Hillary. And we forced them to talk about election fraud. They said it didn't exist. And a month later said it's the worst thing in the world. The Russians are taking over. We've got to federalize everything. I mean, we've got these crooks panicking. But they are crooks that are used to doing whatever they want. I mean, you look at Hillary and you look at Obama. They are Chicago Mafia. And let me tell you, the Chicago Mafia is the worst there is. The sex slavery, the little kids, the stuff they do. And that's who runs us, is people that just hate you. I'm sorry, Larry, just briefly comment. I promise to go to calls. But just, I mean, I'm all over the map here. It's just like, we're here. It's happening. People say it's never going to happen. It's happening all over. The UN's taking over the internet in 4 days, brother. Can you bring Larry Nichols back up, please? Or we lose him? He's open. He must have stepped away while I was
here. I'm here. Yeah, I'm here.
I mean, they're taking over, Larry. I want to go to these calls, but I mean, other points you want to add, the UN takeover.
You know, Alex, we're in trouble deep. And the only thing that I would tell everybody listening to our voices right now, they can't take this country from us. They're going to steal it. And every one of you listening to me, you know, I'm fighting, you know that, Alex, I'm fighting to be here long enough on this planet to be able to fight in this thing. They're going to take it from us, but we've got to fight. And the first thing that everybody's got to learn is don't let them shut your mouth. Don't let them shut your mouth. By that, I mean, don't let them keep using political correctness on you so that when you're talking to others, you're afraid to tell the truth.
Get out of the comfort zone or die.
That's right. Now, you know, guys, I'm telling you, I've been telling you, but if you can't see it now, you're just not looking. They're coming after us. They're coming after us. Now, that sounds scary and all crazy right-wing nut stuff. Look. Open your eyes. Look, Michael Savage, they, like you're saying, they just yanked him off the air. They have the power to yank any of us off of anything. They have the power to come to your house and arrest you for any cause they want to come up with.
And by the way, Savage is a big test right now.
And to see if there's going to be any retaliation. Sure enough, they're going to see what the people will do. And what scares me is I'm afraid a lot of people are just going to switch channels and go to some other program.
That's right. They don't appreciate the fact that this is an absolute war.
That's right. And dear God, I don't know what else to say. I don't know what else to do, Alex.
I hear you, man. It's the nastiness. You know, Hillary. I mean, why are they so evil? Why do they hate everybody?
Let me tell you one thing.
Why do they do the worst stuff to the black communities and then sit there saying they love them? I mean, it's so sick.
Well, let me tell you, it goes back to a Christmas gift I got. The first election I worked with Bill Clinton, getting him elected governor. When it was over, I thought he'd give me a Cadillac because there was no way. He called me, said he wanted me to come over. He had a special present for me, and I thought the man was going to give me a Cadillac because it was quite a deal to get him elected. I got there, and what I had told Bill all during the campaign is to read the book Mein Kampf. And in that book, it proves that if you tell the same lie over and over and over long enough, and that's the only thing that gets out, it becomes true.
So you gave him My Struggle by Adolf Alois Hitler.
Yeah. Well, actually, he gave me, for my big Christmas gift for getting him elected the first time, he gave me an autographed copy of that book, and I needed it like a hole in the head. I'd rather have had the Cadillac. But
wow, he gave you a signed one by Adolf Hitler?
No, well, no, signed by him.
Oh, that's worse. Yeah, I guess.
Yeah. But anyway, that's what they're doing to us now, Alex. That's what's happening. That's why the black community is so susceptible to all of this. They just keep hearing it. They've been programmed
from birth.
That's right. And think about it, guys. If you think I'm not telling you the truth about this, look at Black Lives Matter. The whole premise in Ferguson for the Black Lives Matter, you know, don't shoot, hands up, don't shoot. All of that turned out to prove to be a lie. But you can't convince the blacks on the street today.
Just like it's a black guy shooting the black guy with the black police chief in a Democrat-run city. And right. Why didn't they pick to riot over the innocent black guy shot in Tulsa? Because that lady got indicted. They want bad cases so they can keep it going forever while they discredit the black people on top of it. Man, it's they're amazing. Evil.
And then you look at the guy that was in Seattle, the guy that killed five people. They said he was from Turkey. Well, yeah, Muslim. You know, you're looking at a Muslim, and guys, I'm telling you, the minute I saw his picture, I told several people.
And that's how they're going to get the guns. Picture. They're going to have hundreds of sleeper cells start killing people at the malls, and they won't say none of them are Muslims, just like they wouldn't say the bombings in New York were, you know, a bombing. And then they're going to end up taking our guns.
That's exactly right. And that's why it's incumbent on every one of us, not just you, Alex, not just me. It's incumbent on every person hearing my voice. You're the only way we're going to spread the truth. They're going to keep choking down any alternative information sources. Let's pray that Alex stays around a little longer. They're going to keep choking them down. You've seen it now with Mike Savage. That's for real. They did it. They yanked him off. So the only way we're going to spread it is from us, person to person.
And I want to say we got to go to the calls. They've been real troopers. This broadcast, the films we've made, the videos we put out, what you've done, and other great patriots, they're evergreen. We don't just cover some story of the day and then move on. It's about understanding the larger system. If people save this on computers, save it on hard drives, save it on disk, they admit the new system, they're going to be able to erase all our stuff off the web. But let me tell you, in the future, you have friends over when this country's really deep in it, and you show them what we said years before and it comes true, it'll be like gold. Okay, and I don't want to get to that point, but that's, quite frankly, I've studied history. That's why we just get stronger the stronger the enemy gets, even if I'm long gone or in a gulag. Long after Larry's gone, folks, if the enemy gets its program in, this will be absolute kryptonite to them. That's why you've got to save this data and spread it. Larry?
Yeah, remember, Alex, what did Hitler do? He burned all the books. What did Pol Pot do in Cambodia? I was there. I know. What he did is anybody that could read, anybody that could had any knowledge, he killed them. That's what they're going to do here, Alex. They're going to do everything. When they get control of the internet, they're not just going to take people off. They're going to erase history. And that's what you've got to preserve.
And that's what the cloud can do. That's why they all want you on it. They can hit one button and release a program that will erase my voice or Larry's voice off of entire giant networks.
That's right, and you'll have hell proving that we ever existed, ever. Remember, Alex, this millennial generation that we're talking about nowadays, do you realize that's the first complete generation? The first, what they call the complete generation. It has not touched the way America used to be.
Alex, they've not climbed trees. They've not been in a fist fight. They've not kissed a girl under the apple tree. They just sit there plugged into TVs.
That's it. You and I, our parents were connected to the way things used to be in America. They were connected to their parents. Our grandparents lived the American life that we thought we would all have. The millennials have never seen one word of it. And plus, they're being socially engineered throughout all of the schooling to where now when they come out of college, Alex, they know nothing about education.
Their identity, is to hate Western civilization.
You betcha. They don't know what communist. Look, the majority of the votes cast in the Republican and Democratic primaries, the majority of the votes cast in that election were for an announced socialist and Hillary, a progressive, which is a simple word for communist. And more people voted for it because you know what? They don't know what communism is. I had a young guy tell me, well, that's just an old car. You know, that's
I always see rich college kids in Mercedes, you name it, with all the trappings of capitalism, and they'll be wearing, you know, Mao shirts or hammers and sickles, or they got tattoos of it on them, and they just like it because they know it's evil, and they think it's got power. And well, we, you know, countries.
Well, Alex, it is confusing, but stay the course. Buddy, when you and I met in the 90s, I bet you never dreamed you would have the impact and the audience size that you have today.
Yeah, and I'll tell you, it's not fun. That's what's so ridiculous. These people that think.
If you'll remember what I told you, be careful because you might get what you want and you get to be a Larry Nichols. And it is not fun to be a target, and you are one. You are one.
Well, it's not even being a target I'm tired of. I'm tired of the public being so weak. You know, and just letting themselves be run over because they think they can be delusional and decide they're not getting raped, but they are getting raped, and it's just mind control, and it's sick. Let's go to calls. You guys have been real trippers. In fact, I'm going to send every person on here, if they want it, a free Hillary for prison shirt.
And he sent me one of those, Alex.
I will, and free bumper stickers go with all of them. We're about to phase this out, and I guess just go to Hillary the Dictator shirts, but I guess we'll be shut down by then, so... That's just the way America is now, I guess. Everybody on here, give us your info. We will send you a free Hillary for prison shirt or a bottle of colloidal silver from InfoWarsLive.com. Whatever your choice is. Please, I know that's a lot of work for you, John, but if you'll get their addresses or give them, we should have some kind of free stuff email so people can send their email and who they were, but there's no way to confirm that. Just get their address, and I appreciate it. Everybody's been holding more than an hour, which is everybody on here. James in South Carolina, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Alex, I'm going to start with, I want to plug your Living Defense. I am a disabled father of seven. I suffered from heartburn, excessive gas, just constant pressure. I bought your Living Defense. I live on a disability pension, so I have to make every penny count. I bought your Living Defense while it was on sale. Oh, my gosh, I love it. 3 days, taking it like it says on the bottle, it goes away for months. When it starts to come back, I'll just take it again for 3 days. So this bottle could actually last me a couple years.
Well, James, let me say something. I don't sell something unless I believe in it. And Mother Nature that God gave us is light years better than what any man can give us. And it is such a game changer. Living Defense is... amazing. It is parasite removal, and most people have them. They won't tell you that because they just want to keep treating the symptoms. And Joe Biggs started having gas in his stomach. So I could talk about it if I want, and that he was going to go to the hospital, and he thought, well, I'll take oxy powder. It was just his stomach was like blowing up, that condition, whatever it is, where you just have air in you, and the oxy powder, boom, within a few hours, reversed it. And I'm not saying this is to treat anything. I mean, you need to get doctor approval before you breathe air or drink water. I agree with the FDA. You know, Mother Nature's not good. Vitamin C is evil. Okay, I'm being sarcastic. The point is, consult your healthcare practitioner. But yeah, these are real products. I mean, this is, I will not do something that I would not do to myself. So I'm into Texas hospitality. And I thought everybody was like that growing up. I guess people aren't, but... You know, if I love you, I love you. If I hate you, I'll tell you. And let me tell you something. I won't sell stuff for people to put in their bodies that I don't absolutely bust my butt to make sure is the best. But thank you for the plug, sir. What's your view on the debates, James?
Okay. Now, the first couple callers, I agree with them about the Fourth Amendment. I'd kind of like to hear Trump walk that back. Now, that being said, listen to what Clinton said. She has a plan to fight ISIS on the internet. ISIS doesn't scare me on the internet. She has no plan to fight ISIS on the internet. She has a plan to bind the tongues of people like you, people like Matt Drudge, people like me, people like Larry Nichols. They want to bind our thoughts. They want to quarantine our thoughts, and that's the most dangerous, sickening thing. And you people want to nitpick Trump. And look,
that's right. He should have brought up the alt-right. I mean, she's saying she said in a fundraising letter, Larry, a month ago, that we have no right to exist. That is literal Nazi terminology.
Yeah, it is. And that's what she believes, Alex. She has believed that since the day I met her. I've told you the story about meeting Hillary the first time. That's who she is. And she can dress up. They can put makeup on her. They can try to make her look like better than she does.
Mary Poppins.
Yeah, but it is not. The real Hillary Clinton is the one that stood there in that hearing sentence, or the hearing on Benghazi, and said, "What, they're dead. What difference does it make?" And I've seen her be that way about many people close to her that have died. She don't care. They don't care about nothing.
Well, here's the, I'm not a hateful person, but let me tell you, there is a God, there is a devil, and Hillary Clinton's going straight to hell. I don't normally talk about that with people, but I think it's fair to say she is a demonically controlled person.
Well, you know, Alex, I've told you before, and I never really put anything into it until more recent. You know, I used to have to cover for her to go out to L.A. with Linda Bloodworth Thomas to go to a witch's church. Now, I don't know what a witch's church does, but she told me she was just covering both bases. But I believe she's made her mind up which one she wants to go with. And that sounds horrible.
No. You think you're the only one that knows that. And I'm not stealing your thunder. Actually, I've seen it in a L.A. newspaper, but it was positive that she was at a coven and that she would travel out there and spend weeks with witches. So,
right. And you ought to have been me having to cover up for that in Arkansas in the 70s and 80s. I mean, that was tough. We're in the 80s.
Imagine you're right in the middle of the Bible Belt, and meanwhile, you've got a black witch right there, just drunk on blood. Thank you, James. God bless you for the support and your family. We'll be right back with Sean, Terry, Matt, Leslie. Straight
We're
ahead.
On the march.
I'll give him a shirt. You'll send him some Living Defense.
Alex
he gets everything.
And the GCN Radio Network.
Make sure. Thank you. Living Defense, everything. All right, Larry's having a problem with his phone. All right, we're going to get him back on here in a minute. I think his cordless died or something. That guy's fighting really serious lung cancer. He's a tough guy. We're going to bring him back on here in just a moment. I'm told we did get him back on the line. Speaking of products, Living Defense is so good that I should just get up here and say, you really need this product. I mean, we set about to produce with the top experts the most ridiculously, quite frankly, strong, classic herbal system to flush parasites. And it's strong. But it's non-toxic. It's Mother Nature. And all I know is you take this, you take Oxy Powder, you take X2, you take some Real Vitality. It changes your life. I mean, in a way, it's almost bad because I was exercising twice as hard, three times as hard sometimes, 5 years ago trying to lose weight because I hadn't worked out really hard in like 10 years. I gained 90 plus pounds from 180 to almost 280, like 278, 279. And I'm already a husky guy, but I mean, I don't know. All I know is the more of this stuff I take, the better. I mean, I sometimes only work out twice a week now, and I'm losing weight. Slowly, surely, my muscles are getting bigger. It's ridiculous. I mean, I didn't have the bio-PQQ my body needed, this DNA force. I didn't have the right amount of iodine. I mean, when I went on iodine 4 years ago, our first product, it's proprietary, Deep Earth. Now it's a huge market in it. Nobody goes out and gets the Deep Earth type. It's actually real iodine. I don't get it. Now there's iodine all over the shelves everywhere. People figured it out, but the medical information was always there. But people just didn't do their historical research. And Grip said in about 2 or 3 weeks, you'll probably have detox. Get ready for your skin to get better. But first, a bunch of oil is going to come out. You know, your hair will grow faster. And I'm like, okay, yeah, right. Whatever, you know, I know supplements are important and you need them. And, you know, if I can have my own supplements, then we'll make enough money to actually fund the operation. We just can't do it with sponsorship. And there's some other good, you know, people out there, and we still promote them too. You know, InfoWars Health and InfoWars Team is the most updated site for folks to get the great longevity products. But I still wasn't always following it as a regimen. And then that iodine, within a month, it was everything he said started happening. I mean, because I'd never had really oily skin. There was just stuff coming out of me. It was incredible. I suddenly had all this extra energy, stamina, libido. And it was because I didn't have the good halogen. I was bombarded with the bad halogen. So I'm done talking about it. That's how we fund the operation. Speaking of Larry Nichols, he's battling cancer. He doesn't want me to talk about it, but it's known. And that's how he funds himself. And he gets the medical treatments he needs. And it's important for folks to support his work. He's out there working tirelessly. Make a donation at PayPal, NicholsLive@AOL.com. NicholsLive@AOL.com or Larry Nichols, 58 Kingsington Drive, Conway, Arkansas, 72034. And a lot of folks are noticing, and I'm going to right back to your calls, that I'm a lot calmer than I normally am lately. I mean, I blew up some last week, and it's because confirming we were right about the New World Order, and then now seeing it all come out in the open, and then watching things you'd never think could happen in America happen, and watching the technocracy rise up, and watching people basically lose their souls to TV and comic books and, you know, entertainment and just false reality is mind-blowing. And so fear kind of leaves the equation, and it's more of just, what? And you're more interested just in how people have been locked into this. Let's go to your calls. Everybody that's been holding for an hour, I'm going to give you a free Hillary for President shirt or bottle of colloidal silver. Just tell us, give us your address. We'll shoot it out to you. And I appreciate, I'm shooting folks that have been holding, so four more callers. Let's talk to Leslie in Florida and Sean and others. Go ahead, Leslie. Thanks for holding.
Thank you, Alex. I just want to say one thing. I was very, very disappointed when I first turned on the, and I saw Trump walked out with a blue tie. I'm like,
is he sending a message that he's with the Democrats and then she was wearing red?
Yeah, it really confused me. And then I continued through in the debate. I'm like, why is he babying this debate? Why is he just babying this debate? Why he just don't hit her? And when she talk about ISIS, I was expecting him to hit her real hard. I expected her to shiver, shake, and fall.
Well, here's how I know Trump's for real. I've watched him. I know people that have known him for years, 40 years, and I know about the family. I'm going to stop right there. I know for a fact, okay, that his sons listen to the show, especially Donald Jr., know what's going on. Trump's for real. They always wear red or blue ties. A lot of times Republicans wear them. I think they probably did say to psychologically get Democrats to vote for you, wear the blue. I don't think it was, hey, I'm really on your team, but go ahead.
But I listened to him, but in the end, I don't know if I heard right when he said, I will support you if you win. Did he really say that, or am I hearing wrong?
I missed that. We've got a whole crew that was here. I was covering it live, but half the time my head was spinning, literally. He said, I'll support you if you win.
Did he say that?
Yeah, that's right, because that was actually in the news. And I think it's all for him to look conciliatory. And so he can look big. But
no, you don't play with vipers in their pits, Alex. You don't play with vipers in their pits.
No, I hear you. I think that he was basically showing people that he could be nice and friendly for her supporters that think he's a demon. And they say he's surging in the polls because of it. Time will tell. But she, look, her expiration date is over. She looked like an insane person. I mean, look at the image on screen. She walks around with this fake smile like this. In fact, let me try to get it right on TV. Here it is. I mean, they'll pause it and make fun of me, but I don't care. Here it is. Like, I mean, she looks like a great white shark cresting out of the water. But I hear you, Leslie. I mean, what else do you think about the situation now? I mean, he didn't bring up Benghazi. That's bad.
Oh, he should. You see, I think if he hit Hillary with the truth, you will see Hillary start shivering, shaking, and pop.
I agree. I don't think she could have taken it for 90 minutes if he'd have taken it to her. You know, she looked at him at first like begging that he wouldn't go after her. I appreciate your call. I want to get Larry's take on what you just said. But first, I've got to start getting to some of these clips. And ma'am, stay on hold. I'm going to send you a free Hillary for President t-shirt or colloidal silver, whichever you wish, for holding over an hour. Let's go to the clip of him during the debate saying that he's glad, you know, that he didn't go after her with some of the stuff he had, even though she was being nasty. So I think he was trying to be the big guy there. It was very clear. That's what he was telling us. Here it is.
Do you want to know the truth? I was going to say something extremely rough to Hillary, to her family, and I said to myself, I can't do it. I just can't do it. It's inappropriate. It's not nice. But she spent hundreds of millions of dollars on negative ads on me, many of which are absolutely untrue. They're untrue and they're misrepresentations.
And then he went on further to describe it on Fox and Friends, but he also described it after the debate in a little bit more detail. Let's play that clip after the debate with Donald Trump on the floor.
Anything that you wish you did differently?
No, I'm very happy that I was able to hold back on the indiscretions with respect to Bill Clinton, because I have a lot of respect for Chelsea Clinton, and I just didn't want to say what I was going to say. And
which is,
I'll tell you maybe at the next debate.
Yeah, so I think he's setting it up now where people are going to demand he come out of the gates, and now he'll have cover to really savage her. He's very sophisticated. Larry Nichols, I don't want to doubt Donald Trump here. Again, we have 41 days. We're going to discover this. But what is your gut as an old hand and the guy that used to pretty much run the Clintons when they first got into office? What do you think?
Well, I think they set him up to do just what he did by the way they went after that birther stuff. I think he was put in a situation. I mean, I wish he would have hit her on it. However, you got to realize how structured that event was, where the moderator and Hillary were together. They had already set him up for that birther thing. So if he'd have come out against Bill, then they would have gone, yeah, see, here he goes again. Here he goes again.
And by the way, a lot of people are thinking Lester Holt and her had actually been on the phone or scripted this. It looked very scripted.
Yeah. I mean, look, guys, I've done enough of these things to know. A true debate where you have an independent moderator, that was not.
All they say is you have 3 minutes, you have 1 minute. They don't say anything.
Right. Well, you've got to understand, up until Obama, with what that lady's name was, I don't even remember the big lady, but up until that point, moderators did not interject and do fact-checking. That's absurd.
That's right. You know, no, they had Candy Crowley come in with her BS Crowley fact-checking.
Right. So that's what you've got to watch now. This is how this whole thing has changed, Alex. I mean, it's all changed now. Now you've got,
Think about it. The media sits there, and
you got to fight the moderator.
Exactly. It doesn't. In fact, they've ended debates in America because we don't have real debates anymore because you have a moderator that gets in the ring 40 plus times against Trump and then leaves Hillary completely alone.
That's right. I mean, it'd be just like a boxing match, right?
Yeah, he should have gone after Holt then. He should have gone after Holt. He should have gone Holt halfway and said, Holt, am I debating Hillary or you? Or is it both of you? You want to come up here?
Well, it's not the job in a debate, in the school of debating. You can check it out for yourself. It's not the job of a moderator to intercede in the debate at all, doing any fact checking or any checking. That's not his job.
Absolutely.
It's the opponent's job. But this is how they've changed the whole thing, Alex. That's why it's so hard to beat the Clintons. They have literally changed the whole
That's right. Let's go to
political
Sean.
Political system.
Let's go to Sean in Florida. You're on the air. Go ahead, Sean.
Hey, Jay.
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Hey, bud. Listen, yeah, I'm really pissed off. I mean, I'm a Democrat for 28 years. I got to commend you, and I got to commend Larry Nichols of the Clinton Chronicles. I believe he sued the Clintons. He got out of that mess because he knew it was wrong, and I give him kudos for that. You, brother, you're like in the crosshairs, but you are the tip of the spear for sure. Listen, let me get this off my chest real quick. On CBS News, you go right now on YouTube, it's got like 6 million views. It shows Lester Holt checking like his mic that he couldn't hear, and he kept, you know, it's on there, you can see it. And I looked on Drudge Report days before, and they said no ear pieces at all for the moderator. It was against the commission, and they went through it and ruled it out that he wasn't allowed to have an earpiece. It's totally ridiculous. We're in cuckoo land big time. This is absolutely absurd. He was being forced stuff, you know, to ask Donald Trump questions and try to fact check.
Well, did you notice he looked mad at the end and ran off?
See that part. But I was watching while you guys were talking on your live stream and C-SPAN. You know, while this whole thing was going on. And it's absolutely absurd when they say, you know, when they can get away with this, that the moderator's not supposed to have an earpiece. No ear communication whatsoever. Go back and look it up under Drudge. It's totally pathetic. And this is
sure, we'll look into that. But Larry, I think that is the boomerang here. The total rigging, Hillary being given passes, Trump being nice, Holt still ganging up. I think it is the rigging, the clear, unfair playing field. I think that is the dark horse in all this that just blew up in their face.
Well, absolutely. But I'll say this about Trump. Trump has got to understand this is going to happen to him and use it. Use it. And he didn't. You know, he's got to say things to Hillary that are damning as hell, but they're true. And they cannot be disputed by even a friendly moderator.
And sir, I want you to get back to that, but I want to go back to Sean.
Just right. The caller's right. He was getting cues from a researcher that was covering that thing as it was going on.
Let me say it. It all just came together. I remember the article. It said that the commission said no earpieces confirmed last week. That was final for the moderator so that they, quote, wouldn't be getting cues. Because it's famous that the media will jump on. It's come out and told people, you know, who are reporters, to attack Trump on CNN, MSNBC. But let's put the article up on screen. We just found it. That is confirmed that the they said that there would not be any earpieces for the moderators. But then they ask, what about the candidates? And the commission refused to answer that question and said, we'll only do that basically if we're sued. We're not going to release that information. Very bizarre. And then I remember, I'm getting ready. Holt's about 3-4 minutes late getting on, and I'm saying they're working on his earpiece. I could see them. He took his jacket off, just like I'm wearing one. They took his jacket off, and then they put the earpiece on. I watched it on that TV set 8 feet from me. We got to go back to last night. Guys, it'll be at like, let me think. It'll be at about 8:03 or 8:02 into the tape. Try to find it right now, folks. You will see where I go, look, he's getting an earpiece put on. Look, his earpiece isn't working. And they come in front of everybody, take his jacket off, put the earpiece, clip it to the back of his collar, just like mine is. And mine goes into the control room. Boy, I wish somebody would tell me what to say, but they're in there, you know, tell me when the guest is ready, the guest's phone doesn't work, whatever. But in this case, Holt wasn't supposed to have it, but he did. This is a major scandal. So great point, Sean. I'm glad you point that out. This is cloud cuckoo land. Larry Nichols, go ahead.
Well, that's what I'm talking about, Alex. It's virtually impossible to go into these debates. That's what I tried to tell Trump's people. You can't go into these debates straight up. It's rigged. It's rigged. And it's rigged at every, you know, Trump should have seen that with the headpiece. He should have stopped the debate right then. Now, you want to win president? Do stuff like that. Prove to the people where you stand that he obviously didn't see it or didn't care.
Well, I'm telling you, they did it in front of everybody. Look, it's 8 o'clock. Holt goes up. He's doing this. He's messing with it. He calls over technicians. He takes his jacket off. They replace it. He tests it. He sits down. They call him out. The thing's on. I mean, it's on video.
Well, now it's on video, but let me tell you this. You can bring it out. You can bring the video out showing it. You can put the article up right beside it where it says they're not supposed to have one. And what do you bet? This is how it's rigged, folks. The mainstream media will not touch it with a 10-foot pole. You'll never see it on the mainstream.
Oh, that's how I can tell when I've really put out something powerful. Total yep. Radio silence. No one will cover it.
Yep. Well, that's what we're up against, Alex. That's why I say it's up to us. We can no longer rely.
Alex, I hear you. Can't. Let's come back and talk about that with more callers. Sean in Florida, final comment, 20 seconds.
Hey,
Hey, Jay, listen, if you go on CBS News on YouTube, it has it. It's 2 minutes and 21 seconds. At 19 minutes in, it shows him chewing and he couldn't hear. He's talking in.
Sure, sure. What's the name of the video?
For the presidential debate, Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump, full debate, NBC News on YouTube.
NBC or CBS? NBC or CBS?
That was NBC News. And if you guys have it
on YouTube, you're saying, and it's okay, yeah, no, it's right when it starts, folks. It's 3 minutes before it starts. We need it when we come back from break. I mean, you can say, oh, I don't trust Trump. Hillary, you know what you've got. I mean, that is the establishment monster. By the way, we went to where the guy said this. I covered it last night about 802, 803. I go, what is Lester Holt doing? Something's wrong with his earpiece. And I wasn't thinking, hey, they're not supposed to have an earpiece. And then you see him, and they come over, they're messing with his ear. They pull it off. They take his jacket off. And
say it again. Review.
So what we're going to do right now for TV viewers and radio listeners, but I'll describe this for radio listeners, there's Lester Holt saying, say it again, say it again. You can hear him testing. Go ahead and play this audio from NBC. Okay. Oh, my God. Yeah, hit pause. Back this up 30 seconds.
Mm-hmm.
He's saying, say that again. It is an earpiece, not a lav.
Say it again. Review.
Now, the debate commission said no earpieces. He's clearly getting orders when he attacks Trump later.
Okay. Say it again. Review. Okay.
Now he unhooks it. It's not working right. Just like mine, he unhooks it from the back here. He takes the jacket off. The technician comes, puts a new battery pack on and transmitter, and then replaces his earpiece. He sticks it back in his ear. Here it happens right here. And again, I guess they cut the audio because they don't want folks to hear this. They figure, oh my gosh, Lester's live right now. Because this was at 8 o'clock. I mean, it's supposed to be on. Everybody's watching. And this is the pool feed that came from the Associated Press, not from NBC. NBC had its reporters on big NBC. This is the feed we were watching, too. There were several of these feeds that you could dial into. And I was sitting here going, oh, he's having a problem with his earpiece. Because I can hear him going, test. No, it's having a problem. I can't hear you. All right. They take his jacket off. Is there still no audio? Go ahead and pump the audio up.
No, it's open. They cut his mic.
That's right, because they cut the mic. Okay. That's what I thought. And then he takes it off. And then they put the earpiece back in. They clip it back on his collar and put it back on. These people think we're such morons. And again, I'm busy. You're busy. I was watching it last night. It didn't click. Now listen, let's triple check this because maybe the debate commission changed its mind sometime late last week and said the moderator can have an earpiece. But they wouldn't respond to lawyers that sent them letters saying, hey, we covered this a few days ago. Are you going to have a prohibition against earpieces for the candidates after that whole controversy that we started by simply asking the question? So that's Tuesday, September 27th. Today, debate commission, moderators cannot use earpieces. Get off camera coaching. Now, are they saying that about the new debate coming up? Or are they saying that about the last one? Because I remember last week when they said no, that's Matt Lauer and Lester Holt. Won't be permitted. Wow, a huge controversy. And Paul Watson's about to come into the bullpen here, out of the bullpen, and this would be an article for him. Well, this is incredible. I guess we get a Don Salazar, somebody to write this, but my gosh, thanks to the caller. He called in to remind me, Larry, stay there. I want to come back and get your take on this. I know you got to go, but and then I'm going to hand the baton to Paul Watson, but this is big. He's wearing an earpiece, prohibited. Lester Holt, NBC cheated. Well, who would have thought that? This thing just got more rigged. Wow, he was being flogged to attack Trump. Oh my gosh, they are desperate. Wow. Okay, either way you cut it, we have the Associated Press, we have World Tribune, we have Newsmax and others last week saying, the commission states there will be no earpieces for moderators. But then we dug deeper and Mikhail Thalen found this from page 6 of New York Post. The commission or presidential debates will allow moderators to wear earpieces if they choose, but the executive producer of the commission will be the only person in their ear. So there's definitely a push that, oh, since we brought up earpieces with Hillary, oh, there won't be any earpieces. The media says no earpieces. Then they say, oh, actually, there will be earpieces. So why are they obsessing over earpieces so much? We're going to get to the bottom of this, but Larry Nichols, other points, my friend.
Well, this is an example, Sean. That's incredible of you. Thank you for seeing this and bringing it out, because I sat there and watched the whole thing just like you did, Alex, and I didn't put two and two together. But if you believe that the earpiece was simply to whoever they said it was to, you're crazy. Lester Holt has no computer in front of him. He had no way, Alex, to go with some of the fact checks questions that he came.
That's right. They want to make him look like the authority when they've got a panel of six people in every area, military, economic, you name it, to give him the question, to give him the answer. And that's why he would listen and then look up and go, no, you didn't.
That's
right. And Trump would go, yeah, I did.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Now, I'm going to tell you one other thing. If you want to verify to yourselves that this thing was totally rigged, there is no way, Alex, an honest debate moderator could have gotten through that entire debate without bringing up the emails in Benghazi.
That's right.
No way. No.
So that proves it right there. That's proof of the rigging right there.
That is. I mean, you don't need to see anything else. You don't need to hear anything else. When they block those subjects, you have proof that somebody was blocking information that needed to be talked about. Those are the key issues with Hillary Clinton. Her truth about the emails. And then even when Donald Trump brought it up, Alex, he didn't pursue it. He didn't say, well, Ms. Clinton, what about those emails?
So bottom line, it was totally rigged. What do you expect of the next debate then? That I guess Fox is hosting.
It'll be rigged. It'll be rigged. The only thing that I would hope to be different in the next debate, Alex, is I hope Trump will listen to people that know the Clintons. You got to know how they are going to fight you. And they're going to hit you with everything from every angle there is. You got to be able to fight it. And Trump's got to do what Ronald Reagan did back in the 80s. All right. The media is blocking him. The media is shutting down everything. The debate is the one chance Donald Trump has in front of a good size audience, and the audience size will drop.
That's right. He's got to cut through with his real message and say, the media has never let me talk. They distorted what I've said. Oh, whatever, lady, you're a liar. I was nice to you last time.
That's right.
Just, you know, you're done. Sit over there and, you know, commit more crimes. And what, just ignore him. Ignore the moderator. Just like I did with Piers Morgan. He needs to steamroll him, correct?
Correct. And remember, he sat back and he was nice to Hillary. I'm going to call it that. Nice to Hillary, this debate. Every word out of that woman's mouth was cutting him. And she was saying statements that were 100% not true. She was quoting things that people had said that nobody's ever even heard of. Several of the people I even heard doing recaps of it. The things she said Trump had said about certain genders and everything else, they had never heard of.
And the media's not going to fact check her on that.
Nope. No. So he's got to go in and he's got to realize, hey, I'm surrounded by the enemy. And when you're surrounded by the enemy, a situation to which I have been in many times, not many, but a few times, too many, when you're completely surrounded by the enemy, here's what you do. Start shooting. Just start going. Just let them have it. Let them have it. And then if people think he's not presidential, then you know what, Alex? I don't want a president that's going to take this kind of cheating and this kind of rigging. I don't want somebody that'll live.
No,
like
I hear
that.
You. Absolutely. But the media is so hated, he still won it because it was so staged. But it could have been a bigger victory. I agree with you. Larry, we'll talk to you soon. God bless you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Bye-bye, guys.
I'm going to come back and briefly talk to Paul Watson about the incredible removal of Michael Savage, second biggest talk show in the world, off of the air yesterday for talking about Hillary saying she may have Parkinson's. This is very dangerous. The doomsday clock towards total tyranny just moved closer to midnight. I haven't talked to Paul today. I don't know his view on the debate last night. I know he went out and wrote multiple articles exposing the fact that CNN admittedly rigged the poll. I mean, they say, in our methodology, we had people call in to us that are Democrat viewers, 90%. And then we asked them, are you a Democrat? And we sampled 41% Democrat, 26% Republicans, to then give Hillary a 15-point lead, which is less than the amount of points of Democrats they added to begin with. They add almost double the Democrats in the sample, and then they wonder why Hillary wins by 15 points. And every other poll shows Trump winning, and I think only because they ganged up on him. I think it's a mistake. I'm just going to, I've really been thinking about it, that he did not go after her on Benghazi or just any of it and let her sit there and talk about how he's mean to women when these people are total psychopaths. I mean, the Clintons are scary people, folks. That's why I go up against them, because they're bad people. Somebody's got to be a man around here. I don't say that, you know, to act macho, folks. I'm in the arena with these creatures. They hate my guts. They hated me 18 years ago. Paul's got a lot to cover. There's a bunch of clips we haven't gotten to. Infowars.com is the front lines of this fight, and I want to thank everybody that prays for us, supports us, and spreads the links, the articles, but do not take for granted Infowars. I keep telling you this. They took Michael Savage off yesterday. He's on 400 radio stations, probably the biggest show in the country, probably bigger than Limbaugh, second biggest admittedly. I mean, you could argue late night coast to coast is second biggest, but I mean, they're all right there at that level. But he was hardcore. CBS owns the syndicator. Savage told me a week ago that he was being censored, and I didn't even ask to come on a show. I didn't ask to have him air Paul Watson's piece. He said he wanted to air our interview. Could he? And I said, well, of course you can. Anything you want. Mikasa Sukas. And he said, well, now this is public, I'll tell you. I'm going to call him after the show if I can get a hold of him. That he's really getting jacked with by CBS. He said, up there at the top. And that, you know, he'd like to carry more of what we do. And then we had other chit-chat. Yeah, Matt Drudge, just talked to him. He's listening right now, driving, blah, blah. We'll say hi to Matt Drudge. You say hi to Matt Drudge. And then he went back to some other stuff, and I'm not going to even get into it because it's surreal, though, to be in the same league as Michael Savage. He was calling me, well, you're the leader, Alex. You're the field marshal. We've kind of gotten this point where people are like, actually, Alex, you go ahead and lead it. I mean, and they've already taken him off the air. And, of course, he's not actually saying, Alex, you go lead it. It's more like, yeah, you're a field marshal. But it's kind of the point where, actually, you be the leader because this is not safe. And I'm like, no, you're the leader. No, Matt Drudge, you're the leader. Here, you be the leader. Here, ha, 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 ha. This is big boy time. This is not pretend land. This isn't all the normal BS in media, okay? I mean, Paul Joseph Watson does videos every day or so that on average get about 1 million views. Now imagine, you shoot a video in your house, and you post it, and it gets 1 million views. Your big ones get 5 million. Your really big ones get, what's your latest, 18 million? It was 16 million yesterday. They're censoring Paul. All I'm telling people is, we're making the Death Star trench run here. And I'm not asking for you to go, oh, thank you, Alex. I'm saying, we are on a Death Star trench run here. And as you fund us and support us and pray for us, you're putting power in our guns. You're putting gas in our tank. You are spiritually reinforcing us. Yeah, I was guesstimating saying 18 million from 60 million. It's 17,409,000. And again, that's just one video. We've got videos with 50 million views. CNN doesn't have 17 million viewers in an entire day. They don't get viral videos hardly ever anymore. Or if it is, it's a dog, you know, eating a cat or something, or an alligator being eaten by a snake. It's not their propaganda. It's not their information. No one wants to look at them. They know they've already collapsed. They're a facade that hasn't completely blown over yet, but there's nothing behind it. You walk up like it's a house, you open the door, and you're in a field. It's a facade. And we should Google the image of a house facade and put some images up for TV viewers. Infowars.com/show. But I'm putting everything I can on the line with the new free app. And people say, you say this costs hundreds of thousands of dollars. This is just some video feeds and text articles and blah, blah, blah. That's, I'm saying, when it's done, we're going to be adding more features to it in the next few months, like live events and updates and citizen activism, and where people can actually be contributors and have their own subsections. I mean, this is going to be very big and very, very important. Point is, Infowars.com/app. Get everybody to download it. Because I'm not going to make an attack run on the Death Star to play tiddlywinks. Now, a better analogy is the Death Star is orbiting the planet to attack the moon on the far side. But when the Death Star comes around the planet, there's another equivalent system waiting for it. So it's more like Death Stars are clearing the fire. You understand? But you have to realize there is this battle happening right now between good and evil. And for every action, there's an opposite and equal reaction. You are that opposite and equal reaction. Paul Joseph Watson, I'm going to punch out of here because it's hard to get you to do the show. You're a busy man. And I just really want to say it's good to know you. I'm really proud of the work you've done with us in 15 years. I'm proud of the rest of the crew. But I just want to say I'm proud that we don't serve evil. I'm proud we're hardworking. I'm proud we work hard to tell the truth. And I'm just proud to know you in this foxhole, brother.
Well, feeling's mutual, Alex. And you were talking about the media before. We were talking about it yesterday. They're starting to become self-aware as they crumble, as they collapse. And that Daily Show piece was very telling. I only mentioned it briefly yesterday. But it's Trevor Noah of The Daily Show cracking jokes about this conservative commentator. But then he stops and he gets all serious and he's like, but wait a second. This one video on Facebook by this conservative commentator got 65 million views. That's more than network news. That's more than cable news. That's more than readers of the New York Times and all the major newspapers put together. They're freaking out. They're finally starting to realize that they're being crushed in the real
arena.
They're
coming around the side of the planet and another Death Star is aiming right at them.
Exactly. And now, you know, the Washington Post is saying don't call us the media because 94% of Americans distrust the mainstream media. And they're finally becoming self-aware. And, you know, people like Lester Holt are part of the reason why 94% of Americans distrust the media. Because I came on your show yesterday and said, listen, he's being pressured by NBC internal operatives, by the Clinton campaign. He wasn't.
By the way, we have your clip. I meant to give it to the crew. In fact, let's pull up the clip. In fact, we do have it of Paul Watson yesterday predicting. You talked for like 30 minutes on it, but you predicted Holt would do just this, and I was wrong. I was like, no, he's a pretty good guy. I think he has integrity. He was clearly being flogged by the earpiece to do what he was saying. You could see it in real time.
Exactly, and the point is, it wasn't pressure by the Commission on Presidential Debates, the actual authority that runs the debates, because their executive director came out before and said that it's not a good idea for the moderator to serve as the Encyclopedia Britannica. She came out and said that. It was Robbie Mook, Clinton's campaign manager. It was internal NBC operatives that were putting pressure on him, and this was in CNN before the debate, to be a quote fact checker.
And that's why he ran off. He didn't like being put in the Candy Crowley position. So I'm sure he said, if you want me to do this, you're gonna have to give me Fed information. And it sounded like it turned into bullying by the end, because as they got closer to the end of the debate, they were attacking more and more.
Yeah, and fact checker is just a euphemism for activist moderator. He challenged Trump 6 times on his answers. He didn't challenge Hillary once. He interrupted Trump 41 times compared to just 7 interruptions for Hillary. He's not supposed to allow the audience to make any noise whatsoever, yet he let them laugh 4 times during Clinton's lame jokes. Trump cracks 1 joke, he immediately silences them. And Alex, the media came out a week ago and attacked Trump for saying that he was a Democratic operative. So, oh, another Trump conspiracy theory that Lester Holt is a Democratic operative. Trump was proven completely right once again. He's a rhino. He was pressured into doing this. This was a rigged debate. The facts prove it.
Lester Holt did not look like a happy camper, though, so at least he's not excited about being evil like Megyn Kelly.
Well, she seems to get off on it, yeah. But, you know, what have we got coming up in 10 days or so? Anderson Cooper.
I guess CNN's next, then it's Fox. Known admitted CIA officer, heir to one of the largest fortunes in the world.
Yeah, direct ties to the Clinton Foundation. So later on, when I get on the show, I'm going to go through a list of things that Lester Holt didn't raise. It's a list longer than a massive grocery list, so that's going to be interesting. But the bottom line, Alex, is, you know, Hillary helped launch ISIS and the migrant crisis as Secretary of State.
And then
It's Trump on the defensive for saying Rosie O'Donnell's fat. I mean, how does that make any sense?
Be honest with me. I know you will be. I think he narrowly won because they overplayed it, overcooked it, overstaged it. It was so skewed that that's the only reason he's gone ahead in some swing state polls. I still think that his advisors, not letting Trump be Trump, I think them saying, you know, don't be mean, be presidential, I know they're targeted at 20% that's undecided, but I just really think this is not good. I mean, I think he won, and maybe I'm wrong. What do you think, Paul?
Well, I think it gives him a lot of space to go in the next debate, whereas Hillary's just going to keep reading off her talking points.
And
like
that's
a
his
robot.
Big tell. He kept saying, just wait till the next debate. He played it nice up front. Now the gloves are off. That he's always said, I'm a counterpuncher. So he let her go in there, feel all powerful. I think it's going to be guns a-blazing. Before they say we're threatening Hillary, that's a colloquialism. That's a saying. It's a figure of speech. I think he comes in with a 360 attack next time.
Exactly. And at least he got up there. He wasn't scary. He wasn't literally Hitler as they've tried to define him. So in that way, he made progress.
All right. Well, I'm going to punch out of here. I'm skipping this break so you have more time. Paul, what else is on the radar screen? What else are you concerned about right now?
Well, I'm going to be talking about that rigged poll, obviously, Alex, with CNN. We had immediately Trump won trending as a hashtag on Twitter, which is key, despite whoever hijacked it in the end. That is key for people to see that in the very hours after the debates. And of course, when you clicked on the actual hashtag, it was leftists posting GIFs of people laughing next to the hashtag Trump won versus conservatives, libertarians, Trump supporters posting actual polls that say Trump won. So that was the difference. Of course, you had one CNN poll. They oversampled Democrats. They do this in a lot of the election polls.
And they admitted it almost double. Yeah. That is 41 to 26. I mean, that'd be like if I was playing football and I said, I get 21 players on the field instead of 11, and you get 46. You would laugh at them. I mean, this is insane. I mean, oh, we're sampling almost double Democrats, and oh, look, Hillary won.
And it's nobody's even reporting on it apart from us. They didn't put the methodology on their website in the article. They linked to it, and it was a PDF file on CNN's image server where it actually admitted 41% Democrats were asked compared to just 26% Republicans.
Hey, I want to go back to something just because I'm so interested in it. Again, I don't have time to sit there. I've tried to do it. So the reason I say it's a fraction of it is it's very small. I mean, look, we've had before 3.8 million people tune in during the 2012 election coverage of just internet streams. And I don't know what happened. I don't know why it was so big. We've never had anything else like that. The Nightly News is on some UHF, VHF stations. I never really promoted it, so it's less than 20. But we're a lot of radio stations, I mean, more than 60 or 70 that I know of, they call upon to do an affiliate agreement. I just say, carry the Nightly News whenever you want, okay? I don't care. Just fight the New World Order. Put ads over everything. I don't care. Do it. Take a little bit, take it all. So I always build new stuff, never knowing how it's actually going to succeed. It usually just does something else I didn't expect. But the Nightly News hasn't ever really gone big on TV, but it's gone big on radio, strangely enough. So that's very exciting. But just internet alone, we had about 600,000 people on different platforms, on our different streams that we can look at, tune in. Okay, but then if you go to YouTube, then it's hundreds of thousands more there. But we also have videos every day that have millions of views and then hundreds of other videos, sometimes hundreds of videos a day that have an average about 40,000, 60,000, 100,000 views. But if you look at it all, just our platforms, tens of millions of views a week, very conservative. Like, I shouldn't be conservative. 15, 20 million views a week. Terrestrial radio, 7, 8 million people a week tune in, 2 or 3 million a day. That's just on rated stations. You add it all together, worldwide, other big sites and our videos, it's around 32 million people a week tune into the show. That's not even counting big super viral videos that we put out routinely. So as they become self-aware, Paul, and realize that Paul Watson, on average, is bigger than The Daily Show, just you by yourself, what does that do to these narcissist brains? Because listen, I go to school events. My kids used to be homeschooled. It was great. Now they're older. They want to be on Sports and Friends, so they're in private school. I go, and guess what I hear about when I go to birthday parties or I go to parks or I go to other towns? Guess what the teenagers, girls, boys, you name it, young men, young women, and even like 10-year-olds, who do they want to talk about? Paul Joseph Watson. They want to talk about Ian McGinnis. They want to talk about Alex Jones. How is the establishment going to counter that when all over Central Texas, Paul Watson is a rock star with 15-year-old girls?
They're going to counter it with censorship, Alex. I mean, you can compare just my channel on YouTube alone to the Young Turks. Now, they've built up a massive audience on YouTube, no doubt. But my channel, with just me sitting here on my own, making, what, 2-3 videos a week, is growing twice as fast as the Young Turks, an organization that has, what, 20-30 people working on that
video
production.
And I made you start that YouTube just a few years ago as like a hobby, and it's got hundreds of millions of views, not counting how your stuff gets duplicated everywhere, hundreds of millions more.
Yeah, I mean, I've only been doing it seriously for about, what, 2.5 years. They've been on YouTube since the beginning. They've got a huge team, a huge staff.
They're partnered with it. They were funded by Qatar.
Yeah. They're pumping out videos, you know, 10, 15 times a day. And yet my little channel, just me, is growing twice as fast. I get twice as many subscribers per day as the Young Turks. I put it up on Twitter. You can check it out for yourself.
By the way, I didn't see this Daily Show clip. You should send it to the guys and the gals. We should play that and kind of piggyback on that. Because just to show, there's so many great libertarians, conservatives, patriots that are huge. I'm busy fighting the New World Order. I don't really pay attention to what they're doing. Who is this conservative lady that gets 65 million views on her video?
Well, it's pretty odd because she's on the Blaze Network and yet she's pro-Trump. So it's kind of Glenn Beck's offshoot. But
it's funny, Glenn Beck can't get 10,000 views, but somebody that got on his network, which is great, it's how good things come out of evil, she's now huge.
Yeah, it's because she's resonating with other people in what she's saying. So she gets up on Facebook, she gets, you know, 5 million views per video on average or whatever, but one video in particular gets 65 million views, and The Daily Show does a massive hit piece on her. The Washington Post, The Guardian did a massive hit piece on her, and they're totally freaking out. They're saying, look, this video got even more views than the turtle humping a shoe. This is crazy. This is out of control. This is not funny anymore. What are we going to do to stop this? And it's a very telling clip because he was very serious when he was talking about it.
Well, send it to them. I want to play it because we should say, you know, elite panics over something bigger than turtle humping shoe, hijack all the trendies and reprogram them. I mean, we've got to do this.
No, exactly. I mean, and the frustration is that, you know, we're pumping out content so often, we don't even have time to, like, manage our own Facebook pages. If we actually got them in order, we could have 2-3 times the amount of views. Just don't have time to do it. So, I mean, the growth is exponential. It's going parabolic. You know, I'm disappointed if I get 300,000 views on a video. That's disappointing for me now. I mean, that's the level, and it's only going to get more and more.
Well, I'm not kidding. I mean, and by the way, it's not just young people that like Paul. It's just that when you learn, you know, like the tennis coach tells you, hey, you know, like everybody at the school and other schools watches you and Paul Watson. And I ask him, well, who's more popular? Oh, Paul Watson. So it's kind of like I'm the old guy now, which is great. I've been doing this since I was 21. And you got Paul, been with him 15 years. He's only 30-something now. And it's just good to know they're never going to win this war. I mean, if Hillary thinks she can shut me down or have me killed or whatever, you know, good luck, lady. I wish no harm physically on you. I want you to just leave me and my family alone. So, I mean, if I'm a dinosaur in all this, can you imagine what a dinosaur Hillary is? I mean, I think that's one of our biggest victories here is, Paul, is the globalists are disconnected. They don't realize how defunct they are.
Oh, no, totally. You see that with Hillary Trump after the debates. Even though supposedly Hillary won because of one rigged CNN poll, whatever, okay, she won. 79% of people talking about this debate on Facebook are talking about Trump. He's got far more social media exposure than Hillary Clinton. You could watch the graph for the independents' favorability interest. Whenever Clinton started speaking, it went down. Whenever Trump started speaking, it went up. He's got the momentum. He's got the massive exposure. It could be a Brexit-style scenario where they're completely shocked. This wave comes in, and, you know, people like Scott Adams, respectable people, are saying it's going to be a Trump landslide because of these factors.
Well, internal polls, he's 10 to 15 points ahead. When they lied for a while a few months ago, it shrunk to 6-7 points, but it's right back there. And if he doesn't win, they've stolen the election, and unless there's a false flag. And by the way, I've confirmed what you've been just in the ether predicting from multiple military and police sources. They're trying to develop a case that we are preparing a paramilitary operation against the government. I mean, I literally could barely get my laundry done. I mean, I'm just here like a martyr if I have to just cover this. And if you guys want to burn me at the stake, go ahead. I'm not even, it's like Obi-Wan Kenobi and Darth Vader chopping him in half, to use another cheesy analogy. I mean, we're not giving up, Paul, but clearly they are really trying to organize some type of federal operation that we're like, you know, some type of cult or something.
Oh, completely. Yeah, you go on Twitter, you search for assassinate Trump every single day. It's why hasn't somebody assassinated Trump yet? From all these idiot, violent leftists. Well, people have tried to assassinate Trump. You had Michael Sanford, a British citizen, a couple of months ago, tried to grab an officer's gun and shoot Trump while he was on stage. It got absolutely no mainstream media coverage.
And then meanwhile, we're trying to stop murder, police being killed, civil war. We're trying to get non-GMO food. We're just good people. We're being demonized. I'm going to come back and say bye to Paul. I just love hanging out with Paul. We'll be right back. Stay with us. Let's have a poll on InfoWars. Who can do a better Emperor Palpatine invitation? And it's kind of a split with the crew in there. You got a special guest coming on. I'm going to punch you out here, Paul. I just love talking to you. Thanks for doing a great job over at InfoWars.com and PrisonPlanet.com. And congratulations on having 5 million views every week on average, just on YouTube alone, one platform. I mean, it's great to have, you know, 7, 8, 9 million listeners a week on terrestrial radio, but just to be doing that on the internet, we're doing it on so many platforms. So just adding your views to what we're doing, it's more than 15 million a week, really. I just keep not believing how big our numbers are. It's so exciting. It's a bellwether of the establishment collapsing. But I'm going to go ahead and do my Emperor Palpatine invitation because, you know, how about Emperor Palpatine, you know, for president?
You have done well, Lord Vader. Do what must be done.
All right, I'm kind of getting a little bit of stage fright here. I'm not doing it as good as I normally could.
You have done well, Lord Vader.
Now, you go ahead and do yours. We'll see who can do it better.
You have done well, Lord Vader.
I don't know. I think Paul's better.
You've had a lot more practice than me. You've been doing it for about 15 years.
Well, I've been waiting for this a long time. All right, Paul. Hey, we got free shipping on the products. It's ending today. We've got 20% off on Supermail. This is the last day. Absolutely the last. Vitamin B12. InfoWarsLife.com. Sign up for auto ship, get an additional 10% off. You sign up for a month from now, 6 months, a year, whatever, and then get 10% off. You sign up for auto ship, InfoWarsLife.com. I kind of get a little bit jovial about the fourth hour because we covered some really hardcore news. Lastly, and then go to your guest. How bold is it? We're just sitting here and Michael Savage talks about her illness and says, you know, as an expert, he's got a degree in medicine. I mean, an actual metal degree, the medical degree in herbs. He's got the botanical, actual medical degree, MD degree in herbs. And he says, Hillary looks like she has Parkinson's. We have the email that she wanted Parkinson's medication from WikiLeaks. And he goes and says that he's taken off WABC. He says, I'm being shut down. I'm being taken off. I'm being, quote, total sabotage. We'll put it on screen. Was it total sabotage or absolute sabotage? Point is, sounds like a great... Pure Sabotage. Sounds like a great album cover name. But then I'm going to call him as soon as I get off with you. Pure Sabotage. He's then taken off everywhere and is now off the air. I mean, this is, they've coup d'etat Fox News, taking it over. They now are taking over the rest of the media. It's happening, Paul.
The coup is on. I mean, I don't want people talking about it. Dr. Drew really set that issue off, you know, back about 6 weeks ago. He lost his show almost immediately, and now Savage has got problems. It's no coincidence that it's when he started talking about Hillary's health. They don't want people hearing about it.
All right, Paul. Thank you, my friend. Go ahead and take over.
Okay, we're going to carry on the show here with our guest who is waiting in the wings. He is Derek Pilot, a up-and-coming YouTuber. Goes by the moniker Some Black Guy on YouTube. His Twitter handle is some_black_guy. Derek, welcome to the show.
Hey, Paul. Thanks for having me.
Now, I was going to ask you about the debate, but we don't have much time left here, so let's skip straight to Black Lives Matter. Of course, we had the riots in Charlotte recently. We had the media and Rachel Maddow and MSNBC saying that, you know, they were peaceful protests, even as reporters were being attacked, set on fire, stores looted, you know, drivers attacked, people being beat up on the streets. BLM comes out, as they always do, and say, you know, how dare you lump us in with this fringe violent element? We're a peaceful group. We're not affiliated with them. Yet then they come out with this list of demands which insists that the rioters and the looters be released from prison, which doesn't really sound like a great, you know, way to differentiate yourselves from the violent element. I mean, Derek, from everything you've seen, is it accurate as they claim to describe Black Lives Matter as a peaceful organization?
Absolutely not. At this point, you know, they're always trying to say that, they're always trying to cover and say that, yeah, we're peaceful, you know, but when you just say that, it doesn't mean anything. It's your actions are what's really important. And the thing is, every time there's some type of incident that happens with, you know, a police officer killing a black male or something like that, then you have people that come out and riot and they say, oh, it's not Black Lives Matter. But then you have footage of people chanting, you know, Black Power, wearing Black Lives Matter shirts. And then also, you know, before Black Lives Matter really became a thing, you know, there was always police brutality and things happening like this before. And there wasn't this constant, consistent riot. So I don't like, you know, it's not really, it's not fair for them to say, or it's not accurate for them to say that, oh, we're just peaceful. I know some of them are trying to be peaceful. I know some of them are trying to just be there. And there's been instances where everything was nice. But then all of a sudden you have things like Charlotte, you know, you have things like Milwaukee, and you know, that is absolutely connected to Black Lives Matter.
And I mean, Derek, I make the point over and over again, which people don't seem to pick up on. You look at their ideological guru, and I know you've talked about this in your videos, the foundational inspiration behind Black Lives Matter. Her name is chanted at every demonstration. It's cited by the founders of BLM in their original essays outlining the scope, the motivation behind BLM. It's Assata Shakur. Who is she? She's a convicted cop killer who is on the FBI's most wanted terrorist list. This isn't Martin Luther King. This is a violent radical who, you know, left some of the leftist groups back in the 60s, 70s because they weren't violent enough for her. She's now in exile in Cuba. That's their inspiration. So then they claim that they're a peaceful group. You know, it's like white supremacists saying that Timothy McVeigh is their inspiration and then the media calling them a peaceful group. It just wouldn't happen. I mean, talk about violence. Obviously, there are peaceful people within this group. They're not all violent people. But whenever I make a video criticizing Black Lives Matter, the fact is I get a torrent of death threats, even more death threats than I get from radical Islamists. So, you know, as a black guy, you've criticized Black Lives Matter on a routine basis. What kind of heat do you get when you make those same critiques?
Well, the thing is, it's actually kind of funny because most of the criticism or heat that I get are, I would say, in the 90th percentile from black people. And they just, you know, call me things like, you know, they say I'm an Uncle Tom, I'm a traitor or whatever. And, you know, I've heard it all before. I've even made videos like saying that it doesn't even bother me. Just calling me names does not do anything to me, does not hurt my feelings. And it doesn't make any of the facts less true or anything like that. And so from like from other people, sometimes they're kind of confused. Some black people, sometimes they do hear me out. Sometimes they're like, oh, I never thought of this before. But largely just my criticism comes from the black community, unfortunately. And they just want me to be like them. They're mad that I'm not like them, that I'm not victimizing myself, that I don't think everybody's against me. And, you know, and there's systemic racism because, you know, I don't know how there could be systemic racism when there are black people in every type of field, you know, all the way from being like a garbage person, all the way from being an astronaut. You know, you can be whatever you want to be in this country. You know, you just gotta, you know, you gotta work for it, you know, and it's not about, you know, your skin color. It's not doing anything. It's not holding you back. Like, it's only you victimizing yourself, already saying that you're a victim from the very beginning and saying that you're disadvantaged. You already put yourself at a disadvantage. You know, and like, I'm trying to tell people, especially in the black community, not to think that way because it's poisonous, you know, and that's what's happening like all over the United States.
Well, I mean, it reminds me of Colin Kaepernick. I mean, he came out and said black people in America were oppressed in his own words. Yet, you know, 68% of NFL players are black. They're not exactly oppressed if they're getting, you know, high paid careers. Obviously, there's problems with police brutality, but if you look at the underlying narrative, that impacts both black and white. You know, five white people were killed by police on the same day that Keith Scott was killed, yet they didn't get any media attention. You know, the left criticizes the right when they bring up these kind of arguments. When they bring up, you know, black crime statistics, they say black people are overrepresented, you know, commit 50% of homicides. That's why they have more violent confrontations with police, because they're getting into these situations in the first place. But, you know, the left comes back and says, well, you don't understand walking while black. African-Americans are targeted simply for their skin color. As a black American yourself, You know, is there, do you feel in your day-to-day life when you're walking down the street, this genuine state, this constant fear of cops, is that a real authentic thing or is it overblown in your experience?
Well, in my experience, for me personally, it's not a thing. I've learned from an early age when I first started driving and going down the street that if I'm, you know, minding my own business, not looking sinister in any way, and I'm not talking about my skin color, I'm talking about like certain like posture things, certain clothes that you wear, you know, those are red flags for, you know, for the police. And also, you know, even being in my car. Yeah, there has been a couple of times I've been pulled over, I think, because, you know, just because the neighborhood I lived in, there wasn't very many black people. But the thing is, nothing happened. You know, I wasn't talking back. I wasn't being like a really angry like person, and just I wasn't giving the police officers any reason to have me step out of the car and tase me or whatever and have it escalate. But the thing is, I've also noticed, though, just with people in general, because, you know, I would ride with so many different friends, and they would just get nervous with the police, just, you know, if they're tailing them or just even by, like, people just naturally get nervous. And I don't think it's necessarily just like a black thing. I think people kind of around the cops, they act a certain way, they act a different way. And then sometimes it gets the police, it kind of raises a red flag where they're like, huh, this person's acting strange. Let me investigate, let me check them out or something. But me, yeah, I do not live in fear of the police. I don't think that when I'm going to go drive out my car, I'm going to go drive, I'm going to get shot. I don't think that when I see them, I usually nod. I'm like, hey, how's it going? As a matter of fact, a lot of people don't know that I was actually considering becoming a police officer because, you know, I've always liked the idea of that, where I was living in Arizona. Oh, I'm back here again, but I was going to sign up for one of the police academies. And largely, I kind of just didn't do it. But my whole point is that I don't have just this automatic disdain for the police. I don't think, you know, all cops are terrible. I think that's a stupid generalization to say that about anyone, that all this is this. And so, yeah, in short now, yeah, I have no problem. I live in no fear, like, from the police. They're fine as long as they, you know, leave me alone and everything's cool.
Well, I mean, it's strange that Lil Wayne made similar comments where they were trying to get him to get on board with BLM. And, you know, obviously he's no stranger to scrapes with the law, but even he said he's not really experienced any racism against him. Obviously, that's not the same for everyone. But another thing I wanted to touch on is there's often this argument about, as you mentioned there, the kind of demeanor, the behavior of these individuals who get into violent confrontations with police. It's influenced by the things they're wearing, their attitude, the way they're behaving. How much do you put that down to, you know, ghettos, socioeconomics, and how much do you put it down to the glorification of this gangster culture that we see coming out of hip-hop and rap? Do you think that that's, you know, a significant quantifiable influence on how black people behave, is that we have this kind of glorification of this gangster culture in popular culture and music?
Yeah, I actually think that there's a major influence in that. I remember even being young, like, I was kind of neutral with a lot of stuff. Like, I liked metal and just like EDM and all these different things and hip hop. And then I started to gravitate a little bit more towards that because I'm like, oh, there's so many black people in it. This is cool. And I remember I started writing lyrics, and the lyrics I was writing were so ridiculous, because I was like mimicking the stuff that, you know, most hip hop artists would talk about. You know, most mainstream hip hop artists would talk about all this horrible just trash, you know. And yeah, I started to realize quickly, I'm like, this is not, you know, who I am. This is not who I want to be. And there's so many people that are still just, you know, they're completely in it, and they think that is cool. Like, I mean, yeah, you go. I actually lived in South Central Los Angeles for a couple of years at a time. And just being there, just seeing like how people live on average, and especially when it's almost just as like, it's not, I don't see any benefits of living there. They can move out like my mom did. And it's just horrible. Like, everybody wants to have a gun. Everybody wants to hang out on the corners and just, you know, drink some 40s or whatever. And they're not really trying to do anything but that. And then they try to figure out, oh, I got to make some money. I got to make all this money and stuff. And, you know, okay, I'll just sell some drugs, because that's all these dudes were doing, you know, they're talking about in the you know, all the hip hop songs and stuff. And that's what I see. And it makes sense to me. I mean, like I said, I was almost kind of hooked into it at a certain extent. Like, it somewhat influenced me until I started to just, you know, have a little bit of common sense. And I'm like, this is stupid. And I don't. Oh, and also my mom, she would kill me. So there was that too. Like, I can thank my mom for you know, kind of raising me to not, you know, get me into that type of hip hop culture, because she hated that stuff.
And I mean, there is a lot of, you know, hip hop music that goes the opposite, that encourages people not to get into that kind of lifestyle. But again, it's not picked up by the mainstream. It doesn't get picked up now. But moving on, we've had, you know, polls recently that show the majority of Americans and even more millennials still support Black Lives Matter, even after all the riots, even after all the police shootings, you know, the Dallas massacre of 8 cops. Amongst the African-American community, do you sense a deep well of support for Black Lives Matter? Or do you think that, you know, people are just more disinterested? Or do you find that more, you know, Black Americans are starting to be turned off by Black Lives Matter? What's your impression of that?
Well, there definitely are, and thanks to like channels like yours and mine and other people, there are a lot of Black Americans that are starting to see, because otherwise they weren't really seeing anything. They weren't seeing the, you know, because they're just getting their news from the mainstream media, and all they were seeing was just little clips of peaceful protesting, and seeing that, like, yeah, there's just this big problem with just cops killing Black people. And I'm like, it's not just that. And then when they see the rioting, when they see the videos that I put out. And then they actually get to see, like, you know, a balanced, objective, like, just look at things that are going on. And then they're like, oh, I didn't know. Like, yeah, I'm getting kind of tired of this, and I'm getting tired of the mainstream media's race baiting. And so unfortunately, there's still an overwhelming amount of support for Black Lives Matter from the Black community. I think that's just from, you know, them just being Black. And there's this thing, there's always been this thing, this hive mind mentality of that we're all brothers and sisters and we're all in it together, you know, more than in any other race that I really know. So I think that just because they kind of have to do it, you know, they have to do it. They just don't even really think about it too much. And, you know, obviously, unfortunately, if you put something out to the contrary, it's like there's people saying that if you're against Black Lives Matter, you're against Black lives, you know, and just that they're like, oh, well, I don't want to be against Black lives. I'm Black myself. I have to be, you know, that kind of stuff. Where I'm like, nah, man, this is just another, you know, poisonous ideology, unfortunately. And like I said, I know there's good pockets. Sometimes every once in a while, they do talk about some issues, you know, that I can be like, all right, this is a problem. But I just overall, I don't like what's happening, like, say, riots and stuff. I'm like, that if there's any riots coming from any type of group or something like that, I don't care what type of group it is, I'm not down for it. It's just not a good thing. And I know that as we keep moving forward, hopefully, you know, less and less people will be on this bandwagon of just blindly supporting Black Lives Matter.
And the funny aspect to this from a UK perspective, they had a huge Black Lives Matter protest recently, which shut down an airport. The people went to court, and literally every one of them was a privileged white upper class person whose, you know, parents had bought them a £2 million swank pad in London. They all had triple barreled or quadruple barreled names. So again, as you said, there's this narrative, well, if you oppose Black Lives Matter, you must hate Black people. Well, no, actually, it's an ideology. It's not a race. Just like feminism is an ideology, it's not a gender. We'll be back with Derek Pilot after the break. This is The Alex Jones Show Live. Breaking news at Infowars.com. Stay tuned. We're back. It's the Alex Jones Show Live final segment. We're talking to Derek Pilot, who is an up-and-coming YouTuber. Go and check out his great videos. Now, Derek, we've got a few minutes left here. I want to give you a chance to plug your channel at the end. But just for the next couple of minutes, YouTube censorship. We had the demonetization scandal a few weeks back. You know, that got a ton of media attention. This has got significantly less. It's called YouTube Heroes. Tell us why this is such a concern for free speech and for content creators on YouTube.
Well, the thing that really concerns everybody is because of it, it basically made you get a lot of points for doing certain things. And a couple of things you get points for is like flagging content. So you can flag some videos and you'll get rewarded for doing so. And the reason why a lot of people are concerned, including myself, is the flagging system is already flawed. They already have like very flawed things, like say even copyright claims. Pretty much anybody, even if you use fair use, you can just copyright claim and then, you know, they'll monetize, they'll claim your money. There's so many things that are kind of wrong that need to be fixed. And now they're kind of like encouraging to flag more videos. And there's going to be a lot of people that are going to do that. And then when you get to a certain tier, you can mass flag videos. And the thing is, I'm like, there's people with vendettas, you know, that will want to take your channel down, especially people that are, you know, exercising free speech and that are against censorship. There's a lot of people, you know, there's a lot of people on the left or the social justice warriors, as people call them, that are just trying to censor everybody. They don't want you to say anything. They want you to think a certain way. And they're going to be the people that are going to try to police you. Now, you know, it's very early. And since they try to do some damage control, look like they actually tried to even switch up the video and kind of reword some things here and there without anybody trying to make sure it like nobody would notice. So you can already see that they are trying to like, oh, you know, this was a really bad idea. So I'm actually with the backlash that they're getting from a lot of the content creators. I think maybe something, I don't know if they'll really take it, if they're going to really push forward with like the things, because it's not all bad. The YouTube Heroes thing isn't just completely across the board. There's some things that that are good. For example, like you can get rewarded for putting subtitles on people's on videos. But the thing is, to the contrary, I guess some people are saying that, oh, they're doing that because they want you to, they want to be able to find out what's being said in your video. So maybe it would make it easier to identify what content is inappropriate, you know, and not advertiser friendly. Like, say mine, for example, I use a lot of profanity because it's just how I talk. I mean, you know, I'm just being all good and respectful now. But like, that's what some people are saying. It is very troublesome. It is very worrisome because it seems like they keep doing some stuff that is just making it really hard for you to just be yourself and to really like get the truth out there or just speak your mind. And it's very like, I'm very concerned because I mean, this is right now, this is my livelihood, you know?
Exactly. And I mean, I've already got messages from SJWs, you know, salivating over how they're gonna censor my videos. Just in the final minute here, tell people how they can find you on Twitter, how they can find you on YouTube.
Okay, so if you just go to YouTube and type in Some Black Guy, my videos will pop up, or, you know, youtube.com/someblackguy, whatever, it'll pop up. And on Twitter, you can find me at @some_blackguy. Those are the two things. I'm on Twitter daily, so you can keep up with me. I do a lot of interesting stuff and talk and say a lot of interesting things on there. So yeah, that's pretty much it. I have other social media, but those two things right there are like, you know, keep up with my videos and keep up with my Twitter.
Okay, we're always very keen to have new independent voices on the show. So there goes another. This interview will be up on my YouTube channel tomorrow. So that's all well and good. Go and check out Derek's videos. Derek Pilot, thanks for joining us.
No problem. Thank you for having me.
There goes Derek Pilot. Go and check out his video. That's going to wrap it up for today's show. That's all we've got time for. But again, go to Infowars.com, get the story out about CNN rigging their own poll to make it look as if Hillary won. Absolutely crucial story. Nobody in the mainstream media is talking about it. Alex will be back 11 to 2 tomorrow. Stay tuned, though, for Infowars Nightly News coming up tonight and breaking news at Infowars.com.